Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the committee's 30th meeting in 2020. Could I ask everyone please to make sure their mobile phones are on silent? Now, the meeting is going to be conducted in a hybrid format, with some of our members participating remotely and also with witnesses participating remotely. The first item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private. The committee is asked, therefore, to consider taking item 4 in private. This is to allow the committee to review the evidence heard on the salmon farming in Scotland inquiry update. Is everyone agreed? We are agreed. Therefore, move on to the agenda item 2, which is Salmon Farming Scotland inquiry update. The committee is taking evidence on progress towards the delivery of the recommendations in its 2018 Salmon Farming in Scotland inquiry report. The evidence will be in two panels. Firstly, we'll hear from the regulatory bodies and then from salmon farming interests. Now, in line with the declarations I've made before, when we are considering this, I'd like to declare an interest in a wild salmon fishery on the East Coast. Does anyone else wish to make a declaration of interest? No, I think not. So we'll welcome first panel, who are giving evidence remotely. First of all, Terry O'Hearn, the Chief Executive of Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. Peter Pollard, the Head of Ecology from CEPA as well. Mark Harvey, the team leader on aquaculture for the Highland Council. Charles Allen, the fish health inspectorate group leader at Marine Scotland. And Zoe Crutchfield, the head of licensing operations team for Marine Scotland. Now we are going to turn to our first questions this morning. And the first questions are from John Finney. Good morning, John.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to ask the panel if they could describe the changes that have been made to the regulation of fish farms and the enforcement regime for aquaculture since the committee's inquiry in 2018. Mr. O'Hearn, can you comment on that, please?
Terry O'Hearn, sorry, that's for you. I'm not sure you've been activated yet.
I think I have now.
You are activated. Yes. Yep.
Okay. So there's a few key areas in which we've made changes since the committee's report. There's changes to the conditions which we would apply in our licensing regime. There's changes to the monitoring and assessment. Changes to a tighter approach to compliance and enforcement. So new compliance regime, we have a new enforcement approach, including a new team, plus things like unannounced inspections. My colleague Peter Pollard can give you more details on those. We also have streamlined processes, so more work goes into pre-application where we can work with businesses on, you know, whether a site is appropriate to even look at. And try and cut out some of the unnecessary work in sites that are less favourable, or talk about what sort of technology or size of farm might apply in a particular siting approach. But if you like, Peter could provide a little bit more detail on those issues. Chair, a convener, if you want.
Absolutely, yes, go for it.
Yeah, we introduced our brand new regulatory framework for marine finfish farms in June 2019, based on a lot of consultation with various groups, including coastal community groups and the sector and wider NGO groups. That regime is been in place now for some 17, 18 months. It includes, as Terry says, much greater upfront pre-application discussions, including consultation with communities at the pre-application stage, and advice and help for operators to get the right information about their application so we can assess it when it comes in. It also includes much more streamlined and simple permits focused on the key environmental issues, simple to understand and easier for us to check compliance against. And we've also been putting a lot of work into streamlining our determination process to try and make sure we determine applications as swiftly as possible.
John.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Convener. I wonder, could I ask Mr. Allen or Ms. Crutchfield about the implications of the report and any subsequent changes for Marine Scotland, please?
Charles, do you want to come forward on that first and then followed by Zoe?
There was a great deal of consideration about the reporting of sea lice numbers. At that point, there was a reporting level of 3 adult nidivorous lice and an enforcement level of 8. That has been reduced to 2 and 6, respectively, with a change expected this year to 2 and 4. And further, with regard to sea lice reporting, there is a statutory instrument in chain, literally as we speak. I believe it will be laid early next month, which will require the statutory reporting of sea lice from all seawater aquaculture sites on a weekly basis. That will be submitted to Marine Scotland, subsequent to analysis and use in the regulatory process. That will be published as quickly as possible. As we stand at the moment, it is envisaged that that will be published weekly in arrears at the end of the reporting period.
Zoe, do you want to come in? Because we're going to come back to sea lice, I suspect, later on. So, Zoe.
Okay, yes. Hello there. Regulatory-wise, we have moved the licensing of wellboat discharge, which used to cover, for Marine Scotland, used to do just the wellboats of this. And we've moved that now to SEPA. So SEPA are now controlling all discharges of medicines and other treatments. I don't know if my colleagues from SEPA would like to add anything to that.
Probably not at this
stage. Well, perhaps before the...
John, I want to come back to you, sorry.
Thank you, Camilla. Yes, thanks for this answer. I was going to actually raise the specific example of how Marine Scotland and SEPA might work collaboratively. I have raised an issue with all of you and indeed the local authority regarding wellboats. How do you work together, and are all existing farms now subject to new permit conditions? Rahan, can you maybe comment on the collaboration between the two organisations, please, if indeed there is any?
Yeah, we put a lot of effort into trying to work more closely. I mean, we always put effort into it. We put a lot more in since the committee's report. So I meet regularly with the Director of Marine Scotland. Peter can describe the specifics of what we've done on things like wellboats, but on a range of issues, there's much better, I think, coordination and collaboration. Again, Convener, Peter can explain a couple of the specifics if that will help.
Okay. I didn't quite hear, but who was going to come in on that one?
Well, it was
Peter.
Okay, sorry, Peter. I'm just struggling slightly to hear who's being brought in. So if you, just to help me, because my ears aren't always that perfect, just to enunciate who you'd like to bring in, and I'll try and do it. Peter, and then back to you, John.
Yeah, so I think we've done, as Terry says, we've done a lot more collaboration and with Marine Scotland over the last year, 18 months on a number of fronts, including helping to get the transfer of wellboats to SEPA as smoothly as possible. So that's gone well, and that's now in place. We're also working very closely with Marine Scotland on, as you'll probably hear about later, about trying to develop a new framework for managing the interaction between wild fish and sea lice from farms. We're working on the aquaculture website with Marine Scotland. I think there's more to do, and we're continually looking for how we can strengthen coordination between us, and we'll continue to develop that over the next months and years, I think.
John.
Yep, thank you. And I wonder, could the regulating authorities talk about the locations where there were known and well-evidenced problems? Have these been rectified? And do we have a situation where all existing farms are now subject to new permit conditions. And finally, if I may, I'll just wrap it all into one, convener. My final question would be, what effect have these changes had on the marine environment, please?
Okay, so John, who...
First to Mr. Pollard.
Okay,
Mr. Pollard, please.
Okay, Mr. Pollard, and then Peter, after Peter, we'll, I think, probably try and go to Mark as well, see if he's got something to add on that. Peter.
Okay, first of all, the permit conditions, that's our new regulatory framework, with new permit conditions, we include clearer standards, etc. Those have been applied since June to all new applications for development. So that's now some sort of 44 farms. We are in the process of transitioning all existing farms onto that new permit. We've focused during the COVID-19 outbreak on helping the sector minimise impacts on the environment and protect its staff, maintain food supply and protect fish health. We paused that transition. We're about to start that transition process now. So over the next few months, we'll start to put all existing permits onto the all existing farms onto the new permit conditions. So that's in process. In terms of the evidence of the effect, as I say, we've got 44 permits on the new thing. What those permits require is much greater environmental monitoring to assess performance. And we've had some of the first monitoring coming in from that, and that's showing that those farms are performing or giving us information to what their performance is, much clearer, much better understanding than before. So that's good. So as more farms going on to that, we'll have increasing evidence coming in of their environmental performance.
Okay, Mark, would you like
to... If I could push you in that... Could I push Mr. Pollard on that? I know you have more information. What does the information tell you? Is it having an effect on the marine environment, the change regime?
I think what we're seeing is that when we're authorising new farms under permit, we're finding that they are the data that's coming in. It's only it takes 2 years for a production at sea, so it's into the second year of that we start to see what the effects are. The few that have come in so far, they appear to be complying well with the. What we expected in terms of our performance, staying within the limits that we set.
Okay, Mark, do you want to add something?
Thank you very much.
Mark Harvey.
Hello, sorry, I lost you for a second there as you were putting the question, but perhaps just to go back to say what has changed since the publication of your report. For planning authorities, I have to say probably not a huge amount because the emphasis has remained upon utilising environmental management plans, adaptive management plans through planning conditions, which is something we were doing before your inquiry. What has changed there, though, has been the adoption of minimum standards by Marine Scotland. So Marine Scotland's consultation responses to us now set minimum standards that they expect to see for EMPs, with an emphasis on not only the counting of on-site sea lice, but also requirements for monitoring local populations of wild salmonids, and also connectivity work, you know, in terms of the dispersion of sea lice from the farm. And I think that has served to give EMPs and EMP conditions a good deal more weight. It felt like a sort of statutory support for the approach that local authorities were taking. Other than that, I think in our work, not a lot has changed. I mean, we have seen changes, I think, as a result of that in the industry, with varying degrees of enthusiasm for EMP work, and a degree of cooperation building up within the industry for joint fish management area-wide EMPs and so forth. But at the moment, I have to say that's very few of those have come to fruition at the present time.
Thanks for that. John, are you happy with those answers? I'd like to move on unless you've got a quick question to follow up on.
No, thank you, Convener. As you know, I could ask questions all morning. I'm conscious colleagues have many questions. So thank you to the panel for these answers. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, so the next questions are from Peter Chapman. Peter.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. My colleague John Finney has just been investigating what SEPA has done and what they are doing just now. But I'm keen to look a wee bit further forward, if we can. And the regulatory framework states that SEPA is still reviewing elements of the regulatory framework. And I'm keen to, if we can outline the work that is still ongoing to strengthen regulations and when you expect any new conditions to be applied. Now, maybe Terry would take that first line, maybe on Peter would follow up, possibly.
Terry, would you kick off on that? Hold on, Terry, hold on, just wait a moment. Sorry, you're still muted. There seems to be some problem with picking up people, so let me do it slowly. Terry Ahern, if you'd like to kick off on that, followed by Peter. So Terry, you go first, please.
So on all these questions, I'll let Peter deal with the detail and I won't take up too much of the committee's time. What I'll say is we're in that progressive work, we have prioritised aquaculture over many other sectors because we know of the need to implement the new approach and system. Peter will be able to update you now on where we're up to and what are the next steps.
Okay, Peter. Peter Pollard.
Okay, I'll pick a few areas that I think are important. As we just mentioned, we've recently taken a responsibility for wellboat discharges. And we see enormous opportunity to work with the sector on discharges of these bath treatments via wellboats or otherwise. In particular, helping develop better ways for the sector to be able to demonstrate compliance, but also helping the sector innovate in terms of, for example, introducing methane capture and treatment technologies. So that's a big area that we're developing, and also that includes a review of how we reauthorise medicines more generally to try and modernise that and make it suitable for supporting that sort of direction of travel to a greater innovation to allow medicine use with, at the same time, minimising impact on the environment. That's one area that we're looking at very strongly. We're also looking at how we use better techniques to audit compliance. COVID-19 has taught us a lot. So one of the other areas of development we're looking at is, again, working, and it's very encouraging, the sector is very keen to work with us on this, on using remote technologies to try and understand to see the performance of farms in real time. So that's another area of key development we're looking at around compliance assessment and helping operators demonstrate their complying with permit conditions. I think the other areas we're looking at are really around how we better report performance of the sector. So that's getting information out in a clear and simple way to the public and other interest groups on performance of farms. So we're looking at improvements in how information that's reported to us is made available in accessible forms.
Okay, Peter Chapman, back to you.
Well, One of the things that's been highlighted to us is the potential move to the use of feed limits for regulating the organic output of fish farms. Is that something that you are actively looking at? I mean, that sounds a very important piece of work. Are you doing something on that?
Peter Pollard, is that back to you?
Okay, so we consulted a consultation that closed earlier this year on looking at two options for controlling the organic solids, the feces, the quantity of feces that farms emit into the environment. We looked at two options, the use of biomass or the quantity of feed that you can apply in over a period of time. They do the same thing. We were looking at options that would give operators the easiest way to monitor and show they're complying, and us to independently assess that. So it's really that test about which is easiest to monitor, which is easiest to independently assess. that one of the things that the operators came back to us and said is there's been real developments in how you can monitor biomass in a pen. So we agreed just before COVID that we needed to go out and see that. And we've not prioritised that type of outdoor work in with operators because of COVID. So as soon as COVID is finished, we want to resume that and look again at the ability to look the modern advances in how you monitor biomass, because that's what the real test is, how they monitor and how we assess compliance.
Okay, back to you, Peter Chapman.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, another area of big concern that we've flagged up is the data and analysis gaps in relation to the discharge of medicines and chemicals and the cumulative and additive effects of these in the context of these ongoing developments. I mean, do we know what levels of medicinal discharge or organic waste is harmful to the marine environment? You know, what is the level of uncertainty in our knowledge of the marine environment's capacity to absorb and process different pollutants from fish farms? And if we don't know the answer to these questions, is research ongoing to find the answers to that?
Peter Pollard, I guess that's back to you as well.
So one of the things we've done with our new framework is two things. One is we switched to very advanced computer modelling of discharges, so we can see via medicines or feces to see where the residues and solids go, where they accumulate. We've also introduced a new framework to update the environmental standards we use for organic solids, so that we can understand which environmental standards define what the marine environment can simulate. So we're much better able to test from a modelling point of view where the environment can assist that, and then we've got post authorization monitoring to confirm that. We're still doing some work on medicines. We've just recently switching to, again, advanced community modeling for some of the battery medicines. And we've got ongoing work to look at reviewing some of the medicines to make sure we've understanding the environmental capacity adequately.
I just wonder if Charles Allen, you want to come in on that, and then I'll come back to you, Peter. Charles, do you want to come in on that?
I don't think I had anything to add there with regard to what Peter had to say on assimilation of.
Okay, we'll go straight back to Peter Chapman then. Peter Chapman.
Yeah, just to push Mr. Pollard a wee bit further. I mean, you're working on this, and this is a very important issue. And the ability of the marine environment to absorb these chemicals and the fact that the feces as well. I mean, have you got real concerns that there is an issue here, or are you leaning towards the factor that the marine environment can absorb these pollutants, if you like, successfully? I mean, where are you? What's your gut feeling? Do you feel that we're okay, or are you having concerns, increasing concerns, as you look into the issue?
Peter Pollard, that's back to you, and then we're going to go to the next lot of questions to Colin Smith. Peter.
The first point is different parts of the environment have different abilities to assimilate the environment. So that's one of our key parts of our regulatory framework, is to work out when an application comes in, whether the environment that's going to receive that waste has the ability to assimilate it. So that's part of the process. For example, a couple of years ago, we started to get concerns from various things that one of the medicines being used, emamectin benzoate, which is an in-feed medicine, the environment might not have capacity to absorb that. So we've commissioned work to look at that, the standard for that. And in the meantime, we've adopted an interim approach based on evidence, and there's an ongoing UK level review of that standard. So we constantly keep under review. We get feedback from monitoring, feedback from other research, and we update our approach accordingly. We are constantly trying to do everything we can to make sure we based our work on the latest and best scientific evidence.
Peter, just a quick one from me on that. Could you just clarify to me one of the things that I think that we mentioned in the report about that was the precautionary principle? So what you're saying there is that there is a certain level of pollution which you are prepared to accept, but are you still working on the precautionary principle to make sure that we never get to that tipping balance on the on in the areas that we're concerned about. Peter.
Yeah, we take a very much a risk-based approach to regulation. We assess what the proposal is, and we make sure that the proposal will comply with environmental standards set to protect the environment. That's a risk-based approach based on environmental standards. Where there's any evidence those environmental standards may be out of date and science moved on, we get a review of those standards, which is one I described on OMX and benzoate. And in the meantime, we adopt a precautionary interim approach.
Okay, a risk-based approach just means that if it gets to 90%, you know the risk. Doesn't mean that you've taken the precautionary approach to make sure that we don't get to 90%. Are you telling me you do?
Risk-based approach is always about taking precautions. What we try and do is make sure the precautions are proportionate to the risk.
Okay.
And I think that's what we aim to do.
Right. I'm not sure that got me any further. Colin, I think you've got the next set of questions. Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I ask the panel if you could maybe give us an update on progress that's being made and taken forward the Farmed Fish Health Strategic Framework, in particular the work of the subgroups. I noticed that the steering group was reformatted, and I wondered what the reason for that is. But it'd be good to get an update on what work the subgroups have done to take forward that framework.
I'm trying to look at the panel to see who would like to come in on that. Charles, well volunteered. Charles Allen, you're off.
I think I'm best placed to comment as other than Stipa. I'm the only person who has previously been involved in the work of the Farmfish Health Framework. It processed for a year, and at the back end of last year, a swift in-work review was carried out, and it was recognised that the work needed to be more focused. So the subgroups have actually been disbanded. The plenary group will now be chaired by the Chief Veterinary Officer for Scotland, and she will commission work as she sees fit to deliver on the work of what were previously the subgroups. There are three significant areas that they're going to look at initially. One is mortality by cause. One is ocean acidification and climate change, and the third is the consideration of treatments.
Colin, do you want to come back on that?
Yeah, it sounds like the answer's not a great deal, but it'd be interesting to see what the new steering group does. Can I ask, just turning to the issues of health, can the panel tell me, has there been any enforcement or sanctions taken against businesses for breaching fish health requirements since the committee published a report?
Charles, is that you? Probably followed by Terry, might have some input there. Charles, do you want to say?
I think the simple answer is yes. They are limited, but I am, as a regulator, limited by the sanctions required in the legislation. In the last year, we have served two enforcement notices, both with regard to sea lice. But other than that, no, that is the extent of the sanction which has been served.
Follow up on that, has there been any evidence that sea life levels or fish mortality have improved since the committee's inquiry?
Charles.
Sorry, Computer, were you coming in?
Yeah, no, I said I was trying to tee up broadcasting so that they could come to you first and then Terry O'Hearn next. So I'm sorry if I cut you off. Charles Allen, off you go.
I actually completed a piece of work just last week looking at mortality levels. Mortality levels fluctuate from year to year and indeed from farm to farm. But if we consider mortality level at mortality at an industry level, the level of mortality is remarkably consistent. The level of survival by year class is also remarkably consistent. However, within each year class and between sites, there are significant differences in mortality.
Okay, Terry, do you want to come in on that and then maybe come back to you, Colin, for a further question? Terry.
Again, convener, Peter will be better placed to explain where SEEP is up to on this issue.
Peter, sorry, you've been allocated a question, the answer by Terry.
stepping back a bit, I mean, I think what we're seeing is, in terms of fish health, is a coming together with fish health and environment issues. In some of the potential we see for sea temperatures rising, etc., which has implications for you know, plankton blooms or sea lice or other things that can affect fish. I think it's that we need to see and what to work with the sector on innovation, which will help the sector manage that changing world and keep fish health healthy. And some of that will be choosing locations where they can cope with rising sea temperatures by perhaps taking water from low down, moving to locations where the sea is well mixed. So there's lots of this potential discussion, I think, here around fish health and the changing world, to how we can manage the sector to be sustainable in the future. So I think that's the real opportunity here to think about. There's real challenges as the sea changes, how we manage the sector so we can get sustainable food fish production with minimal environmental impact. And that's where the opportunities are, that coming together of how do we protect fish health in a changing sea climate.
Colin.
I mean, obviously, the level of sea lice, the level that we had, the mortality rate that we had, was of serious concern to the committee. In fact, one of our recommendations was that no expansion should be permitted at sites which report high or significantly increased levels of mortalities until these are addressed. And also, there should be a process in place which allows robust intervention by regulators when serious fish mortality events occur. From what you've said, mortality rates remain the same, but there hasn't really been any action either to stop expansion or any enforcement action. Would that be correct?
Peter, that's you.
In terms of mortalities, we do not have any powers to do that. That's really... it'd be best to talk to Charles, might we have a better input on that one.
Okay. Charles, Alan, it looks like you're going to answer on mortalities.
I think, firstly, if I could come back on something that Peter said, particularly with regard to sea lice and sea lice control. We've seen a number of innovations introduced by industry, which has significantly improved sea lice control. And we don't see mortality directly associated with sea lice now. We would not consider that to be a major cause of death within industry. We do, however, have a complex of issues, which we discussed at committee previously, which is the environmental impact that Peter mentioned with regard to plankton issues and algal blooms. We have significant gill issues which have been introduced with the effect of an amoeba, and there are a complex of gill diseases associated with that. And losses during treatment for sea lice, which are exacerbated by the difficulty that fish have with regard to their gill health. The interventions that I have available to me with regard to mortality are relatively few and more directed towards significant viral diseases. However, we are always cognizant of mortality which is occurring on farm, We do investigate all reports. All of those reports are publicly available. All of the mortality reports which we get are also available.
Colin, do you want to come back briefly on that, and then I'm going to move on to Emma?
I'm just wondering if anyone can comment. It may very well be it's more a planning issue, but you know, the recommendation was very clearly where there is increased levels of mortality, expansion shouldn't be permitted. Has there been any cases where that has happened at all?
I'm struggling to know who. It seems to me that Charles, you're saying that you're monitoring it, but you have no enforcement. Charles, do you want to come back on that?
Directly with regard to the Fish Health Inspectorate and the legal process that we could put in place with regard to mortality are limited. However, at the planning stage, the Fish Health Inspectorate acts as a statutory consultation to that process, and we will make observation with regard to mortality, sea lice control, containment issues like this that will feed more widely into the planning process, which report of that goes to the local authorities for consideration.
So that must lead into Mark Harvey. Do you want to comment on that? And then I'm going to go to Richard Lyle. Mark Harvey.
Yes, agree with Charles there that, I mean, that would be our expectation, that if sites that have particular issues and they come back through the planning system, perhaps for an increase in biomass or for some other reason, then yes, we would expect to hear from the statutory consultees on those issues. Probably worth saying that the range of tools then available to the planning authority in terms of addressing those issues really once again come back to the environmental management plan, the adaptive management plan, unless of course the statutory consultee is effectively coming back with an objection and a reason for refusal. But I think I'm probably fairly safe in saying that that hasn't as yet occurred in the aquaculture regions for Scotland. But once again, the focus for us would be upon trying to address the problem through adaptive management. We'd expect the applicant to come forward with positive proposals on how they could improve the existing situation, and then explain how they're going to monitor that and maintain that improvement over time.
Thank you. Richard Lyle, you wanted to come in with a brief question, I think. Richard.
Yes, thank you, convener. A quick question to Peter Pollard. You mentioned sea temperatures. Are you or anyone else doing any research in regards to increasing sea temperatures?
We're not doing any specific research on sea temperatures, but what we are doing is we're looking at using satellite imagery to understand what is happening in relation to algal blooms. We're doing a big study on that to try and understand where they occur, what they're linked to, and if we can predict them, where they might occur. And that's there to help potentially understand local risks to fish farms, but also to the wider environment.
Okay.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Charles, I know you wanted to come back in, but I'm going to bring Emma on with her questions now. I'm sure you'll get a chance to come back in at a later stage. Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. We've talked a little bit about monitoring and data collection, but I suppose that is related now to algal blooms as well as feces, medicines and chemicals, sea lice numbers. And it is interesting to note that COVID has had an impact on monitoring and data collection. I'm interested in what the current statutory requirements are for collection and monitoring and reporting of the data. Like, how often should it be collected and then published, and then how is it presented?
I'm looking around to see who'd like to go forward on that. Terry, is that something you feel comfortable leading on? Terry O'Hearn.
Just a general comment that we, in this COVID period, we amended requirements for all, well, not all industries, but for several industries to try and get the focus with their limited capacity, particularly in the early days with staff restrictions, et cetera, on the direct environmental impact. So as Peter said, that has interrupted our work a little bit, but Peter can provide more detail on what that did was get people focusing on environmental impact in a crisis period. Peter can comment a little more on where we're up to with the broader monitoring work and how that's going.
Okay. Peter Pollard, I think you're off on that one.
Yeah, so we've had to adapt quite considerably and cut back and prioritise what we do to check compliance. So we have, we're still getting data reports from operators and we check those. Whereas normally we would have gone out to the sites and on site and check the records locally, we had to do that remotely. And we've started doing telephone audits, prioritised telephone audits. Operators have found it much harder to do the environmental monitoring than normal, and we've put in positions to reflect that. It's difficult to do that in a COVID-safe way. We're still getting monitoring in, but there's some is reduced. What we've started, we're just about to start our own environmental monitoring program for marine farms over the winter. We had to pause that again to make sure we could do it safely within government guidelines, but we're about to start that. So you're right that we've had to adapt, prioritise, and start to develop innovative ways. That's why we're now exploring different ways of remote working to pick up our compliance work. And I think that remote stuff will see us forward as well, even beyond COVID. We innovation in how we help operators demonstrate they're compliant is going to be really important.
Emma Harper, back to you.
Another wee supplementary. The committee suggested proposals to strengthen monitoring and assessment. So, I mean, aside from COVID, did you make any changes based on committee's requests?
Terry, you're nodding, and I'm not sure whether that means you want Peter to speak or do you want to speak? Peter.
I'll leave that to Peter.
Peter.
Yes, absolutely. There's much more monitoring required under our new framework of the environmental footprint of the farm. So we operators understand the effect on the environment, and we understand they're complying within the limits of a mixing area around the farm. So we get to the normal practices, much more monitoring being provided by operators, but we also recognise the committee wanted more independent assessment. So in 2019, we began our first ever programme of unannounced environmental surveys and inspections of marine farms. As I say, we've had to radically change that and pause that this year, but that the normal planning expectation is that we will have, alongside operators doing more monitoring, providing us more monitoring information, we'll be having our own unannounced inspections and surveys on top of the normal planned and inspection process that we operate. The new framework is very much more information about farm performance.
Okay. Emma, do you have any further questions?
Just a final question about if there are any regulatory breaches or any environmental, impact assessments, how is that reported?
It's reported directly to the operator straight away to ask them to explain it. But in terms of public reporting, we normally run a compliance assessment scheme, reporting on farms annually. That's been difficult, and we're not going to run that as normal this year. But what we do in on the aquaculture website, compliance with certain conditions, including environmental surveys, reported in, as soon as we get the results on that website. So there's an overall assessment, which is an annual assessment, which is normal. There's a second bit that certain data comes out on the Scotland's aquaculture website in as near real time as possible on key conditions such as environmental quality.
Okay, I think Charles Allen, you wanted to come in on that point. Charles, do you want to come in?
I think I just wanted to address the first point that was raised with regard to operation during these COVID constricted times. At the point of lockdown, we looked hard at what we were required to deliver and identified there were certain things that we could not pause. If there were suspicions of a notifiable disease, we would continue to respond on site to those. And indeed, we've had to respond to two suspected reports. Fortunately, neither have turned out to be positive. But our approach has been similar to Peter's in that we continue to receive our reports with regard to sea lice, with regard to mortality. These are followed up by phone. We have learnt a lot about communication platforms in the last few months, but now we are back in the field. We have risk assessed and identified safe working practices where we can come back onto site. We have prioritised the high risk sites, but as we deliver those, if we have spare time, we will work our way further down the priority list.
Thank you. I think we'll move to the next lot of questions, which are... Oh, sorry, Terry, did you want to come in to just briefly?
Yes, very quickly, Convener. One of the things that we've done since the committee's report is set up an advisory panel, which has the SSPO and some of the member companies, environment groups, Coastal and Communities Network, the other regulators such as Marine Scotland, Nature Scott, the Highlands and Islands Council's representative, and some of the buyers in the supply chain and a few others. That's important. So the last question about set of questions about transparency, for example, in addition to the things that Peter and Charles talked about, we test those with the committee, that advisory panel, and we say, look, this is how we're planning to communicate things. This is how we're planning to publicise data. But we can have the groups around the table and they can have a direct interaction with the set of regulators, with the industry, for example. If it's the people from the environment groups or the community groups, they can explain what sort of information they're looking at, looking for, what's the best way to communicate it. So we've used that advisory panel to pick up a number of the issues the committee's raised, and I just thought I'd bring that in at this point because that is helping us a lot in trying to resolve some of the things that have been controversial and there are very different points of view on.
Thanks, Terry. So now we will go to Mike Rumbles with your questions. Mike.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. One of our major recommendations in our committee report 2 years ago was that the Scottish Government should initiate a spatial planning exercise with a view to developing strategic guidance, specifying those areas across Scotland that are suitable or unsuitable for siting of salmon farms. So in the 2 years since our report, have any changes been made to the planning process that you are aware of for new or expanded fish farms?
I think that's Mark Harvey to start off with that, and then maybe we could come to other people as they want to contribute. Mark.
Yes, thanks, Commander. I think that the short answer to your question is no, there haven't been any formal changes in terms of statutory planning. We don't have any new guidance that places a decision quite in the way that you described there from the report as to an area that is most suitable and areas that are least suitable. However, and I suspect this is where Peter will want to come in at some length, we are aware that that work is being undertaken per all the aquaculture authorities here. I think we're quite we feel quite positive about that work that's being done, and we think it will have some significance for the planning process in the future.
Okay, Peter, Peter Pollard, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I'll cover three areas where we progressed on this in different ways. The first one is in terms of discharges of medicines and organic waste. So what we do really upfront, right at the early stage of pre-application, before any application comes in, we run screening models, and those show communities and the operator where the issues with waste may be, and where the waste goes, where it may be issues, and that helps operators understand whether this, the spot they're proposing to develop is going to be straightforward or there's going to be challenges. It also helps communities understand what the proposal is right up front. So that's the first thing. during COVID, early on in the pandemic, worked very closely with Nature Scotland, and they did an enormous amount of work to update and improve mapping information of where priority mean features are on the seabed, seabed features are, so that you can understand where the sensitive protected features are on the seabed to help inform developers as well as communities about what's there. And the third area we've been working on very closely with colleagues, including Marine Scotland and Mark and local authorities and Nature Scot, is on developing proposals for a new framework for assessing the interaction potential between sea lice from fish farms and wild fish. That's that, that's a technical work, and that framework is intended to be built around identifying which areas are the greatest in, potential for interaction and which have the least. So that, that's ongoing work, and that's really collaborative work across the regulators to come up with that framework. So those are the three main issues: waste, greening, modelling to help understand upfront, understanding where the priority mean features are by improved mapping of those and explaining their sensitivity, and thirdly, the ongoing work to identify where interaction between sea lice and wild fish potential is greatest.
Mike.
Yeah, I'm just a little confused because you've just started by saying that, oh, okay, no guidance is issued, but work was being undertaken. But you've just said that you wait for an application to arrive and then look at it. That's the whole point of the committee's report, that we were saying that this was not the right way to proceed. That the, you know, we were making the point that there needs to be a major spatial planning exercise to develop areas where this should be promoted, and which should be identified as not being suitable. And although work, you know, work's being undertaken, who is undertaking this work? What is the work? And so by whom is it being done? Because I'm getting the impression from the responses that actually nothing much is happening.
Okay, Peter, do you want to go off on that? And then I'm going to bring in Zoe, because recommendation 59 of the report, our report, suggested that Marine Scotland should have the overarching responsibility. So, Peter, would you like to go on that to start with?
Yeah, what I was describing is work that is available before any application received at pre-application, and it's talking about helping understand environmental capacity. But I agree with you, and there is a lot of interest in turning that information along into an actual spatial planning support guide, and that is something that certainly we've discussed with our advisory panel that that Terry mentioned. And there's a big appetite for helping provide that spatial upfront spatial guide. And that's what we're very keen to work with other regulators to develop. The foundation for that was what we started to do, which is understand the basic environmental capacity that will underpin any such guide.
Okay, Zoe, do you want to come in and respond to that?
Yeah. In terms of overall planning, we use the National Marine Plan as our sort of key document. Now, that is due to go through update processes, and part of that update process, I think, we can look in further detail at all the different sectors that are included within the National Marine Plan and how those planning policies all work together. There have also been a number of other planning type initiatives over the last few years. So there's a few different bits of work that are all coming together. And I think it's, probably a question more for our kind of policy colleagues in terms of, it's a very strategic policy question about when that sort of planning needs to be done.
So, could you just answer me? Is recommendation 59 that Marine Scotland take an overarching and coordinating role actually happening? I think that's what Mike was alluding to. I might have got that wrong, Mike.
No, that's right.
Zoe.
I think in terms of the...
Go for it.
Hi. In terms of the National Marine Plan review, yes, that is ongoing. That is some work that we are doing and will be continued to be looked at over the next year. In terms of a bespoke sectoral plan, that's not something that's happening though.
Well, just to remind you, what the committee said is that the current consenting and regulatory framework, which is spread across several regulatory bodies, is confusing and is poorly coordinated. And it goes on to say the committee recommends Marine Scotland should take the lead. You're saying that that's not happening yet. Mark, do you want to come in on that? Mark Harvey? Back to you.
Yes, I just wanted to make the point that just to focus committee's attention towards National Planning Framework 4 and obviously the work that's going on there to deliver a new national planning framework. It's at the moment certainly references being made there to the in the aquaculture section to a an improved spatial planning framework, which I think theoretically could take on board the work that CEPA are pushing forward. But I have to say, I think I can appreciate the frustration of committee members, but introducing a new element to certainly to the planning regime, because even if Marine Scotland were to take the lead, I don't think that would obviously remove the need for the Planning Commission from the process. Introducing that into the system is a well strategic and long-term issue. How it would be delivered for by planning authorities, possibly through regional marine plans, is an equally long-term issue. But I think it's work that needs to be done. I think MPF 4 needs to take account of the spatial planning framework work that's already gone, already been completed, and has some potential for feeding into a spatial planning process.
Mike Rumbles, back to you briefly before we move on to Angus McDonald.
Yeah, I'm slightly alarmed 2 years on from our report, where we said this is a major issue. Correct me if I'm wrong. If I ask the layman question here, the process has been where a fish farm company comes along in the pre-application process to the council and to the other regulators, we'd like to build a fish farm here. And then everything kicks in. What the committee basically said was, this is the wrong way around. We should have a strategic approach to where fish farms should be located and where they shouldn't be located. And Mark was talking about, in theory, this will be part of the process. It strikes me, correct me if I've misunderstood, but it strikes me that nothing actually much has been done here on this really important point.
I'm just looking at the panel members to see if there's somebody who wants to violently disagree with Mike Rumbles. Maybe not violently. Terry O'Hearn.
So Peter described a lot of the critical technical work that sets the foundation for that sort of broader plan that the committee's recommended. So that I don't think it's fair to say nothing has been done that advances what the committee was suggesting should happen, but it is fair to say we haven't, if I've got the input from others right, formally started that process of developing the type of plan you've talked about. And I'm happy to convener take that up with Annabelle Turpie, the new Director of Marine Scotland, about where we're up to on that and how we can work together in the future, if that would help.
Thank you. I think it would. And I'm now going to go to Angus McDonald, who's got the next question. Angus, good morning.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. Just briefly, we've discussed in some detail earlier the issue of mortalities, but just for the record, when serious fish mortality events occur, are levels of mortality taken into consideration when consenting to expansion, and what's the current approach to addressing sites with high fish mortality? Briefly.
Is that Peter? Is that something you'd like to head off on, start with?
I can say that from the way we are set up to regulate fish farms, the history of mortality is not a direct relevant consideration.
Okay. Sorry, that surprised me. Charles Allen. Charles.
I was actually expecting you to come to me to be first, convener. We, at the point where we are considering an application, if it is a modification
then we will look at the history of the site. If it is a new application, we will consider the history of the company. And when I was trying to come back in on a point which Mark made earlier with regard to him not being aware of objections being raised on history, without identifying the individual company, there were a number of requests for a change in equipment and biomass in a large sea loch on the west coast. And we considered the application, and whilst we were content to accept the change in equipment, we made indication to the council in question that we would object formally to the change in biomass at the time, because at the time we felt that the company concerned did not demonstrate that they had control, particularly of sea lice and some consideration of mortality.
Angus, back to you if you want to do a follow-up on that. Angus,
yeah, no follow-up, convener, but certainly pleased to hear that a precedent has been set with regard to that case. If I could turn to the issue of community benefits. Now, we know that local communities have continued to raise concerns with regard to farm developments, and some perceive that the fish farms do not provide as much benefit to the local community as has been claimed. So can I ask the panel, how are benefits to the local community evaluated as part of the consenting and licensing process for new developments?
I think we'll go to Mark Harvey just to start off on that, and then I'll bring other people in as necessary. Mark?
Yeah, it is a material planning consideration, but I have to say, perhaps I'm speaking here with a rather sky-centric viewpoint, where that has tended to be addressed in the applications we've been dealing with here, it's the playoff or the competition between the creation of employment and directly and indirectly by the fish farm proposal versus the impact upon tourism. So one industry versus another. Our guidance has had to be to members that it's an almost impossible assessment to make, and we've indicated that at present we don't feel that considerable weight should be placed upon it, but that is certainly that is the discussion. So on one side it is, well, it will create local jobs. On the other side, the argument is, well, it could damage local employment through the loss of tourism. Now, as I say, that's a particularly sky-centric view, because at the moment, obviously, tourism is has taken such an important place within the local economy. Whilst we try and make an assessment, I think it is extremely difficult to do so. We know both factors are probably correct, but trying to weigh them up is extremely difficult.
Okay, I'm now going to look at the rest of the panel to see if Terry, you want to come in on that. Terry Ahern.
So in the process, we each have statutory responsibilities as planning authorities or regulators, and so what I would say from CEPA's point of view, I mean, we have to assess applications on the environmental impacts that under law we need to consider. So we do that on those merits. That doesn't mean we can't make a contribution to the broader debate. So a couple of simple things, as Peter has described, we've tried to provide more accurate information, more upfront information, more information that is accessible to both the proponent and people with an interest. And then again, you can go to a broader level. So at our advisory panel, for example, one of the topics we've discussed recently is the issue of waste collection, which was again one of the recommendations of the committee's report. That raises questions of, if there are people with proposals to collect the waste, what happens to the waste? Now, the waste would need to be turned into an input for another industry. Where will that be? Is that in that local community? Is it somewhere else? So what we're trying to do is be very careful. We discharge our statutory responsibilities and don't overstep the mark, but at the same time, get people together and say, here are the possibilities or opportunities or problems that come from various types of industry developments or proposals, so that we can play a role in making sure people are well informed to have the public debate that they should be having, and try and find as much common ground as they have. And if they have disagreement, that that's aired and can be resolved.
Thank you. Angus, are you happy with those answers? And if so, I'm going to move on to Maureen. Angus.
Yeah, that's fine. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Angus. Maureen Mott, Deputy Convener, you have some questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Can I ask what your current assessment is on fish escapes? We have heard of a number over the past months, and I wondered if there are any new prevention or indeed enforcement mechanisms, including penalties, that have been developed or are in consideration. And I wonder, in terms of the fish escapes, you could tell us what you believe the reasons have been for those.
As that's a regulatory thing, I'm assuming that SEPA have the responsibility for that. Terry, do you want to talk on that? No?
No, it's actually Marines.
Okay, so nothing to do with SEPA, so that's fine. Charles Allen, you want to talk on that?
The regulatory approach is laid out in the 2007 Act, Agriculture and Fisheries Scotland. It allows me to carry out inspections. It allows me to make a judgment with regard to the measures in place for the containment of fish, prevention of escapes, and indeed recapture methods if an escape were to occur. And that is the limit of the regulatory process. Where measures are deemed not to be satisfactory, an enforcement notice may be served, requiring the carrying out of works or other measures. Where that process is exhausted and identified not to have been complied with satisfactorily, at that point, a criminal offence has been committed. Evidence may be collected and presented to a procurator for consideration for prosecution. That is the regulatory framework. Coming back to your question with regard to calls, the three largest causes listed for cause of escape are, I know it appears simplistic, holes in nets is the single largest cause of escape, followed by human error and issues with regard to predation. Every escape or circumstance which may give rise to an escape is required to be reported. Each of those will be followed up. Most will result in a site inspection, a report, recommendations. Depending on the findings, we may then go down the formal route of enforcement. I do have a concern in the back of my head going forwards. One issue which was mentioned in the report, but we haven't touched on in the follow-up meeting today, is with regard to acoustic deterrence and other preventative measures with regard to predators. We are going to have to revisit how we consider satisfactory measures, because the number of measures which will be available to industry will be restricted by laws governing other aspects of the marine environment. We will be looking far more closely at industry's ability to successfully maintain their containment capacity, very largely due to maintenance of their equipment and their netting.
Maureen.
That's very interesting. I suppose, are you saying then that standards within the industry are slipping in terms of maintenance of netting? I mean, I thought it had to be double netting now, and that the netting had to be of a certain type in order to prevent seal entry. And in terms of what you said about acoustic devices and things, would you like to expand on that a bit, please, Mr. Allen?
Charles, if you briefly on the briefly on the netting and then the acoustic deterrence for Maureen.
Yeah, I'm not suggesting that standards are slipping. It is that the standard is going to have to realign to legislative changes elsewhere regarding regulation of the fish farming industry. So rather than there being a suite of measures being available, the ability to shoot rogue predators, to use ADDs at wide frequency and amplitude, and maintenance of netting and equipment. From our point of view, assessing the satisfactory measures for the containment of fish is going to be far more focused on the equipment installed. And we are already in discussion with industry with regard to how that standard may be maintained. And indeed, there is a Scottish technical standard, which was published in 2015, which lays out requirements, and we continue to develop that, possibly bring it to a point of use as a regulatory tool.
Just as a follow-up to that, have there been any prosecutions in terms of escapes and people not meeting the standards, companies not meeting the standards?
Charles.
There have not been any prosecutions. It is not a prosecutable offence to have an escape. It is whether or not the measures that you have in place, whether they are satisfactory. If they are not satisfactory, I can enforce to seek satisfaction. And if that satisfaction is not met, that is the point at which the offence occurs.
Okay. So are you saying there haven't been any criminal prosecutions? I mean, you mentioned criminal prosecutions earlier. Have there not been any?
There have not.
Maureen, before we move on, can I just bring in Peter and come back to you? Would that be all right? Peter Chapman, you wanted to come in. Itching.
I was keen to come in. We were told during the evidence that escapes in Norway, the various companies had to try and recapture the fish if they escaped. Is there a similar regime in Scotland? And if so, is it satisfactory? Does it work? Can you realistically catch these escaped fish?
Charles, are you out there with your fishing rod?
Briefly, in some circumstances, it is reasonable to require recapture. However, there is, as there often is, a conflict. The measures that you would generally put in place for recapture would be the use of netting. And you're required to seek license for that. And one of the factors included is that in attempting to recapture farmed fish, you may well capture wild fish. So certainly when we have asked fishery boards and trusts their opinion, they often do not wish to see recapture methods deployed because of the impact it may have on the wild fish.
That leads me nicely into my next question. Obviously, you are tasked with being responsible for the health of the farmed salmon, but in the work that you do, do you take into account how measures might affect the health of wild salmon and trout, for example?
The Fish Health Inspectorate don't specifically have regulatory responsibility for the wild fish. Where we are looking at aspects of aquaculture which may impact on the wild fish population, we would seek information from our colleagues at the Freshwater Lab in Pitlochry. With regard to planning applications, that is done in every case, and the evidence that they provide to us, we then pass on to the planning authority. When it comes to disease, we do have a limited role in that we are required to monitor or rule out the presence of listed disease in wild fish. And indeed, we carry out a number of diagnostic cases every year looking at instance of disease in wild fish. But the regulation of wild fish with regard to population does not fall to the Fish Health Inspectorate.
Just help me, Charles. The recent escape of 50,000 fish from the Maui farm on the West Coast, what actions did you take there? It would just help me understand what actions you're actually taking in circumstances such as that.
The escape was reported to us. We had inspectors on site later in the week. From what we observed on site, we have made a number of recommendations to the company with regard to their action in the future. More widely, there is a project between Marine Scotland and Fishery Management Scotland looking at the base genetic structure of the wild fish population, and that will be monitored into the future to see if a change in that genetic structure has taken place, influenced by any introgression of genes from the farmed fish escape.
So just a very final quick question on that. If you had ordered the recapture of the fish that had escaped, do you have the facilities to do that on site? You know, like we have fire engines available if there's a fire. Well, do the fish farms have the ability to catch those fish, or is that just a wishful thought?
They generally have agreements with people who have better skill in recapture or capture of fish. Many have agreements with boards, trusts, or other organisations who may be able to deploy those recapture methods quickly.
Sorry, I'm just imagining 50,000 fish swimming around a West Coast lock that you believe that there's somebody out there with the netting capabilities to catch them all up. I'm not sure I've heard that.
That is one of the contingencies that is available to farmers.
Okay, fine. Stuart Stevenson, over to you. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. We've had a couple of references in earlier question to interactions between wild and farm stock. Peter Pollard referred to lice. We've been talking about escapes just now, and we had a sort of sideways reference to water temperature. So this is the subject I want to explore, because clearly the catching of wild fish is a significant economic activity that matters to many communities, just as farm fish. But of course, it's beyond the debate that the number of wild fish has been in decline for a very long time, long before there were fish farms. Indeed, when I worked for the Tay Salmon Fisheries Board, 52 years ago, it was a matter of enormous concern there. So really what I want to know is who is responsible overall, and I think this is a recurring theme in the committee's questioning about just making sure we understand who gets fired if it doesn't work, is kind of the crude way of looking at it. Who is responsible for monitoring that interaction between farmed fish facilities and the wild fish population? And of course, I'm not necessarily assuming that there is a meaningful interaction, because on the East Coast, we've seen as big declines as we have in the West Coast, and there are no farms on the East Coast. So is there an interaction that matters, and who's responsible for monitoring and reacting to it? Perhaps I'll just direct that in the first instance to Peter Pollard, since he's got ecology in his title, and this sounds to me as a layperson as an ecological question. Peter.
Okay, thanks. I'll start with the big picture one. Do we think that sea lice from farmed fish are responsible for the declines that we've seen over the decades in wild fish? No. There's a complex of reasons, some of which are probably to do with high seas changes. So the issue is whether the state of the populations at the moment can be affected by the added pressure of further sea lice as they migrate to sea. So that there is it's not suggesting that the declines over the last few decades are due to fish farming. The concern is with stocks, wild stocks at such low levels, whether the additional pressure of sea lice is now significant. So that's where that is. In terms of work, after the committee's inquiries, the Cabinet Secretaries, Chief Cabinet Secretary, set up a salmon interactions working group to look at the interactions, both from escapes, but also from sea lice. And it made a series of recommendations, which was reported in May. And that interactions group had an independent chair, but it also had representatives of wild fisheries interests and the salmon and trout producers. In parallel with that, the regulators have set up a technical working group, which has been developing proposals on the sea lice wild fish interaction and how to manage the added risk that sea lice from farm expansions may pose. That technical work is nearing completion, and in terms of taking it forward, that's a matter for obviously for Scottish ministers to think about how to do that and how that's implemented and when, and following public consultation. So that's where that process is up. So it's followed from the committee inquiries, setting up the salmon interactions working group, setting up a technical working group, and that's getting close to decision on how to take forward. Mark Harvey might like to describe the existing arrangements.
Well, sorry, just before we move on to another witness, if I may, Peter, that's a very welcome set of activities, and I'm not going to pick at that, but it didn't answer, give me your view on the question of who actually is the lead, or what part of the organisations that we have is the lead in taking responsibility for the consequences of interaction between wild fish and farmed fish facilities. Is it you? I'm not meaning you as an individual, I hasten to add, but is it SEPA? Is it somewhere else? Because I think that's one of the things the committee is struggling with. Just where does it sit? You know, if we want to come back to this subject, who do we get in front of us?
Okay. So the regulatory arrangements are at the moment are that in terms of deciding on a new development and its potential for interaction between sea lice and wild fish, that sits with local authorities with advice from Marine Scotland and others. That is a difficult position because at the moment there is an absence of a clear risk assessment framework or deciding on the risk. That's what the technical working group has been trying to do, is develop that clear evidence-based risk assessment framework so decisions can be made. In parallel with that, it's up to whether there's future changes in regulatory roles and responsibilities, that's a matter for the Scottish ministers, and I can't really say what they will choose in that space. But certainly in terms of the current arrangements, it's local authorities. What the technical working group has been doing is trying to make it that process work better by getting a clear risk assessment framework, evidence-based one, that whoever the regulator going forward is could deal with.
Okay, Stuart, if I could just bring in Charles Allen and Mark Harvey just to answer your specific question on who's in charge.
Sure.
Peter,
that's exactly what I want to happen, convener. And may I say, convener, just for the record, I haven't yet heard a view of who's in charge, and I suspect the committee will be forced to conclude that we don't know if we don't get an answer and go from there. Charles Allen.
I'm agreeing with you, Stuart. I haven't either. Peter, followed by Mark. Charles, followed by Mark.
I think it's probably reasonable to observe that no single individual person, group, body is in charge, and that different aspects of the interaction will be considered by different people. I think perhaps that this is more a matter of policy than of regulation. And if I may defer it to colleagues who I believe are appearing in front of you at some point in the near future.
Okay, Mark, do you want to add anything to that? Are you in charge?
Yes. I'll be a bit more forefront. I think we are, and I think this was the point that we made. We tried to make it a couple of years ago. You know, and it's probably a situation. When ultimately we're talking about the health of wild fish, getting up of a new fish farm, or the granting of a planning permission, we were the only regulatory body that were in a yes or no situation as to whether that development should go ahead because of its impact upon wild fish. That's where we came in with the EMPs and adaptive management. We weren't particularly happy 2 years ago. I'd have to say, having spoken to my aquaculture colleagues in the last couple of days, we're still not very happy about being in that position. Setting up the EMPs, making them work in a properly adaptive way is a tough task for authorities that are already struggling with resources. That is why earlier I said that we were very positive about the work that Peter and his team at CEPA were carrying out. Now, that work could be delivered through the planning system, or I think perhaps something that hasn't been mentioned so far is theoretically, it's a big decision, I guess, it could be delivered through a licensing system, a different system entirely. But yes, I you know, that. We're positive about the work that's been carried out, but not so positive about how it will be addressed by a regulatory mechanism, which would answer your question, who would then be the regulator with responsibility for protecting wild fish stocks? At the moment, it's us. It might be better if it was somebody else.
Okay, Stuart, I'm going to come back to you for one further question, and then I want to go to Richard Lyle. And try and wrap this one up, if I may. Stuart.
No, that's fine, convener, and I think we probably got an answer. That I don't think it's Highland Council, I think it's the councils in general is the point I take. I think the only other thing that I want to ask, and we've kind of touched on it, is just who is making an independent assessment of the overall salmon fishing, salmon farming sector. And then I will have no further questions, convener.
And who would you like to put that to? Because I can only put it to one, Stuart. You choose.
Well, let's ask SEPA, shall we?
Terry, or are you going to slide it to Peter?
No, I think the answer is, as has come through in some of the questions, and particularly the last one, the different organisations have responsibilities for different components. So no one is making an overall independent assessment. What we're trying to do is, again, in line with the committee's recommendations, is bring that work together much more coherently so that we're better linked up. So there isn't an individual overall assessment. We do our own components in a much better linked up way and try and provide the information to people in a much more coordinated and transparent way.
Okay, Terry, thank you. Which goes back to recommendation 59 in the report for those that read it. Now, Richard, I think you have a question. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, convener. Gentlemen and lady, I'm sorry. One concern I have, to my mind, nothing seems to have been done since the committee published their report 2 years ago. With the greatest respect to all, nothing on planning, nothing on escapes, nothing on sea temperatures. Basically, all work in your own silos. So what has changed in the last years? Anyone? Can you tell me?
Gosh, what a difficult question. I usually have in the committee, when that happens, the chance for everyone to look away, and the last person to look away is the person who gets volunteered to do it. But as you're not here, and Terry Ahern put his hand up, he can answer the question for Richard Lyle. Terry.
Well, again, I'm obviously mainly talk in terms of SEPA. So we've had the biggest overhaul of the way we regulate. As Peter has described, there's new monitoring requirements. We've changed permitting and licensing requirements. We've created an enforcement team, dedicated enforcement team, for the first time. And one of its priorities is to work with the aquaculture sector on compliance. So there's a range of things that have happened. You're clearly expressing that you're not satisfied that we've gone quickly or far enough, but certainly think, as I've said to the committee before, I found this one of the most difficult sectors to regulate, and it's because of the nature of the industry. You know, most of what an EPA regulates is on land and is easy to see and touch, etc. This is more complex, but we've made it one of our highest priorities, and we do believe we are making progress in a number of ways. So I would just stand by the points that Peter has made in terms of progress we have made, and we know there's more we need to do. COVID has interrupted with that, but we've tried to do our best to mitigate the impact that that's had and keep pushing forward. And in fact, we found some things, as Peter said, in adjusting through COVID, not just with this industry, but other industries that we think can add value in the future. But obviously, we're clearly not convincing you, and we've got more work to do to improve our performance and to convince you of it.
Okay, thank you. And probably that's the best place to leave it. I apologise to Oliver Mundell, who didn't get the questions that he wanted to ask, but we will raise those with the appropriate people in a written letter after this. Could I just remind committee members that the Cabinet Secretary will be joining us on the 2nd of December to help answer some of these questions, Richard specifically, which we don't have had answers to. So I'm sure he'll be looking forward to that session as much as we are. Could I thank Terry, Zoe, Mark, Peter and Charles for the evidence they've given this morning. I think it became more flowing as we got the microphones turning on at the right moment. So thank you very much for all the time you've given and the answers you've given. I'm now going to suspend the committee meeting for 5 minutes to allow a changeover of witnesses before we start on our panel two. Thank you very much, and I suspend the meeting. I'd now like to reconvene this meeting and move on to the second panel that we have. And I'd like to welcome from the Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation, who are giving evidence remotely, Tavish Scott, who's the Chief Executive Officer, Anne Anderson, Sustainability Director, and Ben Hatfield, the Managing Director of Maui Scotland. Now, I think we have quite a lot of questions to ask, and so therefore I'm going to go straight into... Well, I'm actually sort of worried that we've got so many questions to ask that we might just go straight on to that. Unless, Tavish, you can speak for less than 2 minutes. If you can give me an undertaking, you'll do that. I'll let you have an opening statement for 2 minutes maximum.
Well, thank you very much, Convener, and a very good morning. I'll do my best to be very brief. What I really wanted to say, it does come down to 2 points, and that is that we furnished the committee with a wealth of information on the changes the sector has delivered on since your earlier report 2 years ago. And across fish health and welfare, the environment, transparency and data, and wild fish interactions, we've gone further than you've asked, and rightly so. And we can go through the detail of that in response to your questions this morning. The second point I'll simply make is this, that Scotland must improve its productivity. That is why, rather than asking for less regulation, we look for better, more efficient regulation. And if I may say so, this morning's questions from parliamentarians have rather made that point for me. I thought your questions simply served to illustrate what needs to happen to enhance what you want as a committee and what we want as a sector as well. So I'll leave it at that and very happy to deal with your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Tavish. The first questions then are from Oliver Mundell. Oliver.
Thank you, Convener. I think you know, it's fair to say, listening to the first session, it doesn't feel from this side of the table that there's you know, an awful lot of progress since the report. You know, we've heard you know that there are some regulatory changes. How have the SSPO and the wider industry responded to these? And where is the tangible progress?
I tell you what would be really helpful, sorry, just because I can see you all on the screen. Whoever would like to come in first, if they just raise their hand, I can see that on the screen and I'll call you in. As no one did that to start with, Tavish, do you want to start off and then go to Anne Anderson?
Good morning, Mr. Mundell. A very important question, and it would be very important that Anne gave you detail on exactly what has happened. I'll simply rest on the point I made in my opening remarks, and that is that we are very conscious of the direction of travel that the committee set out a couple of years ago. We believe in the written evidence we gave you prior to the committee, we set out what we've done as a sector, and Anne can give you much greater breadth and granularity to that.
Okay, Anne, you wanted to speak.
Yeah, thank you, Tavish, and thank you for the question. We have been working very closely with the regulatory delivery partners for Scottish Government, and one of the key things is around ensuring that there is the right level of evidence and information available. So, you know, you heard earlier around the additional monitoring environment and platform, which SEPA has based its regulatory information on. Key to that is being able to evidence our impacts and clearly investing into these areas, together with investing significantly into our freshwater areas of farming, such that when we get to sea, we are as effective as we can be. I noted earlier the question on feed, and I think that's a really important one, a very good example, actually, of the multiple benefits that the industry has done in relation to the use of feed and efficiencies. Feed, as you know, for ourselves, diet is so important, and of course, it's so important for our fish too. Investing in high efficient feed and getting our feed conversion time ratios down to less than 1.2 kilogram, in fact ever closer to 1 kilogram of feed producing 1 kilogram of salmon, actually means that the discharges and fecal discharge from our marine pens is reducing as we become more efficient in that feed conversion. And of course the diets are very bespoke. It's a unique feature of Scottish quality farm salmon, is how well we feed our fish, such that they are given as much strength in that move to sea. Managing the regulation within the environment and is all about balancing in the fish health. We heard earlier around those multiple regulatory platforms and elements of silo thinking. One of the key things for us is ensuring that we have access to suitable levels of medicines sufficient to manage our health of the fish, as well as those other treatment mechanisms. And substantial investment have been made by companies across the sector,
Anne,
investing in wellboat technology.
Anne. I was just going to just rein you back a wee bit so you didn't have to answer all the questions that were raised at the first session in your first answer, because you'll then upset Ben, who's sitting waiting patiently to come in. I'm sure a lot of those points that you raised will come up later. So, Ben, succinctly, now that Anne has taken up a lot of your time, please.
Good morning.
No, I can't hear you, Ben.
Can you hear me now?
That's better.
Okay, so I'm pleased to say that the industry has responded really strongly, particularly in the area where you saw from the previous, that the wild fish and the farmed fish interactions has fallen between the stools. So what we have done is increased transparency markedly, publishing sea lice mortality and disease status. So, you know, if you want to go on, it's equivalent to going into a company and looking at its books. We have moved forward with a conservation fund aimed at improving the habitat of wild fish and working in partnership with the wild fish sector. We've worked hard to quantify the impacts of sea lice and escapes, and made significant progress on escapes.
Oliver, do you want to come back on that?
Yeah, it was just whether you feel there has been a material change in the sort of 2 years, because I didn't hear that really from the first panel, and you know I'm hearing lots of kind of things that are maybe being done a wee bit better or kind of pushing around the edges, but you know certainly looking you know, at the timescale for delivering on the pledges in your charter, you know what's actually been delivered. You know, when will it be delivered and what of the activities outlined are already underway?
Ben, you wanted to come back on that.
No.
Ben, I'm sorry, I don't know if you can hear me. We are really struggling to hear you. I don't know if there's another form of connection that you can conjure up, but I'm struggling to hear you. Try it again.
What I was trying to say was that we move a lot quicker than the regulator. No disrespect to them. The industry hasn't sat on its hands here. We move forward very quickly with the recommendations, and we're very happy to evidence that in detail either today or in written statement.
Ben, we are really struggling to hear you. I'm sorry. I do want to hear your contribution. I don't suppose you could. There's headphones or something that we might be able to try. I'll go to Tavish if I may, and in the hope that I can come back to you, Tavish.
Yes, certainly. I mean, I think the point that Mr. Mundell's driving at has two aspects to it. The first is in the evidence that we provided to the committee, which respond to the recommendations that your committee made in 2018, we've set out in some detail, and Anne can augment this, we've set out in some detail how we've not just met the broad spread of your recommendations, but specifically how our member companies have invested in solutions, both in science and in technical solutions to the very points that the committee drove at and looked to the sector to respond to in that period. And I would very strongly suggest that we have made a big, big shift in the areas that you were asking of us to do. The issue of regulation is maybe, we could maybe come on to that, but that's obviously questions you will have for, and had rather, for the regulators. On Mr. Mundell's second point about our sustainability charter, thank you indeed for raising that. The objective there is to set out, and that's what we did last week, to set out both some short-term objectives and some key principles, but also some longer-term objectives for the sector as a whole, for our member companies. That process was driven by a widespread consultation, not just with member companies, but also with broader stakeholders. And it's why we are seeking to meet exactly the same kind of objectives in terms of net zero emissions from greenhouse gas in by 2045, in the same way that the Scottish Government is, the same way as the United Nations is, and so on and so forth. So we are aligning ourselves with not just the efforts here in Scotland, but worldwide, play our part in tackling climate change. Now, Anne is very much the brains behind all of that. And again, if it would help Mr. Mundell, she could set out more of the thinking behind the sustainability charter.
Well, before she does, I'm going to bring Oliver back in and then give Anne a brief chance to come back. Oliver.
It was really just to go back to Tavish Scott and just ask, you know, in terms of specific timescales, what does short-term mean and what does long-term mean? What, you know, what is the timescale for delivering on these pledges?
Anne, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, absolutely. So within our charter, we set out the needs for establishing very clearly our sustainability baseline. That's work that's underway now, and we will be reporting on that next year. Part of that exercise, Mr. Mundell, will be to establish short, medium and long term targets, so measurable, accountable and realistic targets. And we will be reporting annually on our successes as much as we will report on those elements that we have not delivered. And we'll explain very clearly why that is the case. It's a very broad sustainability charter. It is highly ambitious, and we, like many other sectors, do not have all the answers to be able to deliver that ultimate ambition of net zero in greenhouse gas. But I think what it clearly states is our sector's ambition to be part of that journey and to work with others to deliver it, stimulating, we believe, very strong growth within our supply chain, both across all the SME businesses in Scotland, of which there are many.
OK, Ben, do you want to come in briefly and we can check to see, or has he disappeared? I think he's going through a reconnection process. Ben, are you there? Did you hear the answers?
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
We can. It sounds a lot better. Let's hope it remains.
Right. I'm really sorry about that, but I managed to find someone who's more capable with IT than I am.
Okay, perfect. You're back in. Oliver, are you happy with the answer you've got?
I just wondered if Anne was able to give us you even one sort of specific where we'd expect to see something delivered in the next 12 months on terms of the charter. You know, it's a one thing, you know, that in a year's time we'd expect to see.
Anne, you're off.
Yes, I very much hope to be able to provide you details of some very early trials that we're doing. You heard from Terry Ahern earlier on organic waste capture technology. We're currently trialling some locally generated innovation in Scotland for our specific situations. So the measures that we've set out, some of them we are actively engaged on, others we are building on existing strengths. And that example, Mr. Mundell, is one that I hope to be able to report in our annual report next year and give an indication of where we intend to go next in that particular area.
Thank you. We're going to move on to the next set of questions then that come from John Finney. John, you're on.
Thank you very much indeed, convener, and good morning, panel. I just would pick up on the point that Mr. Mundell touched on earlier. And thanks to the panel for the information you have provided, and with regard to the sustainability charter, and I note the terms Mr. Scott used, objectives, and I think Mr. Anderson used the term targets. Your sustainability charter outlines actions that the SSPO and its members say they will take. And I note the phrase and welcome the phrase, we will be good neighbours in every way. But what are the concrete outcomes? I know you touched on one, Ms. Anderson. What are the concrete outcomes you're committed to achieving? And importantly, are these actions sufficient to address the challenges that the industry has been told it must tackle? Perhaps to Ms. Anderson, please.
Anne. Hold on, Anne. Just pause. Anne, start again.
Can you hear?
We can now. Just start again.
Okay, lovely. Thank you, Mr. Finney. What we did in establishing our charter was to very clearly hear from all stakeholders. We invited the Coastal Community Network. They provided us some written information. We had and heard from environmental NGOs and public bodies representatives based across the country and within our memberships and supply chain. So community was represented, albeit by different terminologies across the piece. And one of the key aspects we were looking at was given, and I know we've submitted to you our report of what we have done in the last 2 years, and it was very much around building on those strengths, identifying the big actions as well as those small actions and all things in between, very much looking to establish on every point where we can provide multiple benefits. So you will note in our fish welfare section, we refer to the need to bring in new pen infrastructure. Pen infrastructure is a very key, is something that is very designed. It's designed and built for a purpose. And of course, innovation in pen design means that we can get multiple benefits in moving forwards with new infrastructure. It's also an area that we're working very closely with our regulators on to establish ways of expediting what for us is our fences on our farms in a way that is swift, enables investment, and it allows elements of control and prevention and retreat in terms of larger pens if with predators circling around them. But it also allows us to put in barriers, and it allows us then to bring in well boats on either side to be able to expedite and manage any health conditions on farms. So that's an example from an environmental perspective that provides benefit. It also provides welfare benefit. And our document, our charter, is riddled with elements like that, where we're looking at the information we have, given we're in locations, and the wildlife information is a very good example of that. My farming colleagues are fascinated and very careful about the farming environment they work in, and they have observational records, which we discovered from hearing from stakeholders, are immense value to not just charitable organisations interested in wildlife, but for local communities and local businesses and wildlife tourism. So sharing information and being very much part of that wider community that we live and operate within is invested right across our document.
John Finney, back to you.
Thank you, Convener. I note your answer. I think you have fairly significant public relations challenge, and one of the aspects of that, to perhaps direct this to Mr. Scott, is about the industry growth projections. Scott, and I wonder if I can put a number of points to you. Do you believe they're compatible with the capacity of the environment, the ability to deliver high standards of animal welfare at scale, and probably importantly, the ability to coexist with other marine users and local communities and not adversely impact them? So, looking ahead, growth projections, could you comment on that, please?
Tavish.
Well, thank you, Mr. Finney. It's an important area. The main point for me, and I may say this with all my old hats on from Shetland, is that when we are working in the marine environment, we work in collaboration with all those other marine users. I know, for example, salmon farming in Shetland is successful because it works with all the others in the coastal waters, and that has to happen right around the coastline of Scotland. And in addition to that, we are the most heavily regulated industry. So therefore, I think it's very important to recognise two points here. Yes, we wish to sustainably develop. We wish to grow the value of the sector. We are, after all, Scotland's number one food export sector, something I think Scotland should be very proud of. I hope Parliament's very proud of as well. But we need to do that very responsibly, and we are acutely aware of the pressures that we face. I think on the point you make about PR, I think it's very important to recognise that 12,000 people work directly and indirectly in the sector, and for companies, 3,600 companies who service the sector. That's a lot of jobs in 73 separate constituencies right across Scotland. And believe me, as someone who used to represent them, I think they care very much about how well this sector does, and they want us to be, as I say, responsible and sustainable in our actions. Hence why Anne has just been speaking to the Sustainability Charter. We will do and act in that way, in absolute consistency with the charter we've just set out.
John.
Thank you very much indeed for that, and absolutely recognise. And perhaps the very unfortunate thing about this debate is it's people ask, are you for or against? And that's a loaded question to start with. So I absolutely take on board what you say. Can I ask particularly about the growth with the capacity of the environment? We had someone on from Highland Council recently there. There's a view that, for instance, the island of Skye, it's a capacity there. Are there other areas? The overlap between local authority areas and the regimes that exist there. You've no doubts that there is capacity to deal with this growth, which is significantly trumpeted by the Scottish Government, of course.
Tavish.
Well, I think it's probably best to give Mr. Finney a proper answer on that, to have Anne and Ben talk to it, because I think there is a lot of sensible science behind this, in addition to the regulation. In other words, we cannot do anything were we not to be allowed and consented to do so as a sector, and rightly so. We want appropriate regulation to develop sustainably our sector. But perhaps I could ask Anne and Ben to speak to the important science behind Mr. Finney's very fair question.
Well, I'm going to give Ben the first chance so that Anne doesn't cut down his speaking time. So, Ben, if you'd like to go on that.
The question was touched upon 2 years ago, but in order to have a successful farming operation, you need to have a great environment to grow the fish in. You know, salmon are an indicator species. They need really high water quality. So just putting a number on growth is actually not the right way to do it. Talk about growth with improved animal welfare, with improved environmental performance, with improved sustainability. It is where it should be. This industry will grow globally. I hope that it will grow in Scotland, but it is difficult to grow in Scotland. The regulation is strong, although it's a bit fragmented. But it's incumbent on us as key players in the industry to make sure that we grow in a good way. Both from a productivity, a profitability, and a kind of environmental stewardship approach. And I think we've made progress on that in the last 2 years.
Okay, Anne, very briefly.
Can you briefly say what you meant, Mr. Hadfield, by fragmented regulatory approach?
John, I missed part of your question, but I did hear what you said, and so did Ben. So, Ben, off you go, and then I'll bring in Anne.
The regulation in Scotland is some of the strongest that we see, but it's quite siloed, as Mr. Lyle said before. There are elements of it that should be addressed better and in a more coordinated way. And one of the things that we can openly agree on is that the interaction with wild fisheries, with wild salmonids, needs to be better. The industry hasn't sat on its hands and just accepted that. We've really stepped up in terms of our work with the wild fisheries sector. We've put in place complete transparency on lice levels, on disease, on mortality events on farms. Some of it's still negative, but at least it's openly discussed. We've put in place a fund for conservation projects, because when you want groups to work together, you've got to get them to work together around some resources. And when we've approached the interactions working group with some really significant voluntary controls that we're going to recommend to regulators that would improve the relationship, So I feel that we have delivered in the last 2 years, maybe not 100%, but we've really stepped up to deliver in the absence of, or in this presence of a siloed regulatory landscape.
And very briefly.
Just that point around environmental capacity. Our environmental performance is improving year on year, Mr. Finney. And indeed, you know, we're in the process of receiving all our results from SEPA for 2019, and I hope to be in a position very shortly thereafter to be able to publish the collated findings. But there's also work that we've done to demonstrate the very precautionary nature of some of the areas around medicine residue discharge, and we're working closely with SEPA to establish new ways of modelling, providing information associated with that, because that's exceptionally key to any sector that manages live species to have access to sufficient quantities, not just for our farm fish, but also to support keeping and maintaining our low sea lice numbers so that they don't then impact in those wild salmon that pass our farms. And I don't have anything else to add at this point.
Thank you. Thank you, John.
Thank you, Camina.
John, are you satisfied with your answers?
I'm concluded. Thank you, Convener.
For a nice way of putting that. Thank you, John. Richard Lyle, I think you have the next question. Richard.
Thank you, Convener. Morning to all our panel. And I actually agree with Tavis Scott and Ben Hadfield that we have to improve and increase our salmon, our farm salmon production with improved regulation, direction and help from agencies. But we also, in our inquiry report, voice comments rewild salmon, which is quite an ongoing situation. And can I ask, the Sustainability Charter commits to developing a wild salmon monitoring programme to provide evidence-based conservation of wild salmon. Is acting to prevent impacts on wild salmon based on this future evidence base also part of your commitment? And what form do you anticipate this prevention to take? Question to Anne.
Anne, briefly.
Thank you, Mr. Lyle. Yes, absolutely. We're very committed to provide and be part of working with other users of that shared water space, so both government and other marine sectors, to ensure that the monitoring plan for wild salmon is not just West Coast focused, but is right across Scotland. Indeed, Scottish Government recently established the Wild Salmon Steering Group. This is part of their efforts around conservation of our iconic species. And we have, as Mr. Hadfield referenced, put in considerable effort in dialogue as part of the Salmon Interactions Working Group, all aimed at ensuring that there is balance and suitable, credible evidence. We've recently committed and delighted to do so to join the Atlantic Salmon Trust's West Coast Migration Project as a full partner. That's a particular gap within the information on wild salmon, where they travel. And of course, we will benefit from that information in informing where we farm. So it's an utter commitment to us responsible farmers to be part of ensuring that we have the right information to then inform decisions in respect to wild salmon.
Richard. Richard, do you want to Richard, do you want to follow?
Can you know, I've lost sound.
We can see and hear you. Okay, we may move on, and once we re-establish connection with Richard, we may try and come back to him. I think the next question, therefore, is from Peter Chapman. Peter.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, folks. SSBO members, including Maui Scotland, continue to have high-profile escape events, and the most recent in August of this year when 50,000 salmon escaped. So what is the current view of these events? What do you feel is their primary causes, and how is the industry trying to ensure that these escapes do not happen in future?
I guess, Ben, that probably is going to come to you to start with. Ben.
So it was a Maui, Scotland farm where we had lots of over 48,000 fish in Kilbrannan Sound in Carradale. I guess the first thing to say is it's very serious and we take it very seriously. So we were disappointed by that. The level of escapes over the last 20 years has dropped markedly in the industry, and that's against the background of the industry increasing production volumes. If you look at the last 5 years, there was a 62% reduction on the previous 5 years. So that's 2016, 2020. But I'll not sit here and say that we're satisfied with our own performance. We have increasingly expanded in offshore high energy locations. And we've done that because the hazard that potentially is posed from sea lice to wild fish is a lot less. The level of waste assimilation is much higher. They're generally a more sustainable place to grow this sector, but they come with them a very challenging marine environment. And we had had over a series of years a good track record, putting in the highest standard of equipment. We've got fantastic people, really skilled people operating these exposed environments. And we've done a lot of great things to create jobs and infrastructure on islands like Muck and Rum and Colonsay. But I am disappointed with the escape event. I was involved in it personally when it happened for about 5 days. We communicated very transparently what had happened. We took steps to secure all the equipment in advance of this winter. It was an unprecedented storm event in combination with high tides. And we've worked with FMS to put in place one of the largest genetic integration studies to look at any potential effects of this that we've seen in Scotland. And finally, I have apologised for it as leader of the company, and we will work tirelessly to make sure that the trend with escapes goes down. But I don't try and say that it's not negative.
Peter.
Yeah, well, thanks for that, Ben. I mean, basically you're saying it's a weather thing. Many of these cages further offshore, the weather is more severe, and that's has an effect on the cage itself. What effect does seals have? We've heard that seals can be an issue in making holes in nets. So I wonder about that. Another thing I would ask, we asked the previous panel, and I'll ask you: Did you make any attempt to try to recapture any of these fish? And in your opinion, is it feasible to try to do that? I do believe it. In Norway, they have to try and capture them. What's the situation in Scotland, and what was the situation in that particular event where you did lose these fish?
Ben.
When it occurs, and it occurs with reducing frequency all over because of the improvement in equipment and containment. But when it occurs in Norway and Chile, there is a much quicker focus and of recapture. We actually wanted and proposed to recapture the fish. We have equipment on standby. Someone asked before, I think it was yourself, convener, do we have fire trucks on standby or the equivalent of? The answer to that is yes, we do. We have a number of containers where we store equipment for recapture. We have people that are skilled at it, and we work with a number of boards to make sure that we've got that capacity. In regards to the Carradale escape, we actually had a purse seiner brought from the East Coast and on standby in the harbour at Carradale, Campbelltown. Sorry. And that was just in case the escape got any worse. So we really moved quickly to do that. What I would say is that the fish were immature. The fish were less than 1 year at sea. So although 48,000 escaped, the rate of predation of these fish is immense. What we've seen so far is around 400 fish turn up in the rivers. And because those fish are immature, they will have to wait 1 year without food to spawn this time next year. So we expect the impact from this to be relatively low, although the number is high. But it's not acceptable. And so the industry is focused on achieving a year with zero escapes, and there has been progress made towards that. In terms of the seals question, within a very short space of time, the ability to control seals using acoustic deterrents or to dispatch a persistent seal that's damaging the pens and impacting fish welfare, that's been taken away from the industry.
and therefore the risk of escapes due to seal predation is higher. One of the ways that the government and the regulators could help is make it easier for farm salmon operators to move more quickly to improve the equipment and in heavier specification pens and nets. And given that we've been severely disadvantaged against our global competitors, we really need that help.
Okay. Peter, do you want to come back on that?
No, I think we've unless you have a follow-up.
No, I was wanting to drift back to Richard Love, who disappeared into the ether. So, Richard, I think you had a follow-up. Would you like to briefly bring it in?
So, sorry, convener, I lost sound, so my apology to the committee and to the panel. I said earlier that agencies are working in their own silos. What needs to be done to improve this for your organisation or organisations?
I'm going to bring Anne in on the basis that she probably knows the agencies well. Briefly, Anne, if you'd like to answer that.
Yes, I think one of the key things is streamlining. So the marine activity, Mr. Lyle, has four permissions associated with it from four different bodies, two of which are within Marine Scotland. Each of these processes has separate consultation, and they're all consultees of each other. And there's also three, four public application and public consultation processes that feature, and not a single one of them naturally then fits and runs at the same time. There is no sort of order of running. So our activity, we've mentioned before the complex nature of it. And it's not really measured or visible in its totality at any one time because of the way that the system's set up. And of course, that concern about the gap that was identified around wild fish, for example, and the lead authority for wild fish still remains the case. So I think streamlining of the process now, I would suggest that getting to a point where there's a single determination with all the facts on the table at the one time, and then balancing the choices that are being made around fish health with the choices on environment and those welfare issues that exist between both is really, really critical for our sector, because of course those are the choices that we have in front of us. It's the information and how we address farming is with everything right front and central and to then inform the decisions we take. I think it's appropriate that something similar to that is how we manage the farming process, and indeed it would align with how other marine sectors are actually regulated within that marine space too.
Thank you, Anne. I hope that answers your question, Richard. I'm going to go back to Peter, who had a second part to his.
Thanks for letting me back in.
Peter.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Moving on, the Sustainability Charter commits to diverting, reducing and reusing waste and establishing a circular economy for organic waste. So what is the timescale for mainstreaming these activities? And do you anticipate that in the future farms will no longer deposit waste into the marine environment? Is that something that we can achieve in the foreseeable future?
Ben, I'm going to let you go on that one, looking to the future. Ben.
I think there is a need for a more circular economy in salmon farming in Scotland, but we shouldn't forget that salmon farming is one of the lowest emitters of CO2 of any kind of mainstream protein choice that you can make to eat. So we need people to eat more fish. And in terms of health, I think that the case is clear there. In terms of the environment, it's a good choice to reduce CO2 profile. There is work that needs to be done on logistics and packaging. But in terms of a circular economy, there needs to be improvement made to the way that we dispose of any mortality that occurs. We are increasingly farming numbers of cleaner fish now, such that it's likely we will not have to take cleaner fish from the wild in a few years' time, or at least a very reduced number. But once the cleaner fish have cohabited with the salmon and controlled sea lice, then we need to have an acceptable method of reusing those cleaner fish for fish meal purposes and fed to other species. So the industry is focused on this, and it's an important part of the charter that's been submitted.
Okay. I think Ben, Peter's happy with that. So I'm going to move on to the next questions, which are from Angus McDonald. Angus.
Okay, thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. The SSPO update that the committee received recently refers to operations being decommissioned or ceased at some farm locations that did not meet producers' environmental impact aspirations. So can I ask the panel, what were these decisions based on, and what work is underway to evaluate where existing sites are appropriate, and where have new developments would be appropriate based on the environmental capacity?
And I'm probably going to go to Ben on that, because he might want to talk about, is it Loch Ewe or somewhere else, Ben?
And I'm happy to answer that question. I mean, the industry as a whole is increasing its sustainability by choosing more open locations or locations that assimilate the waste on the seabed, particularly to a greater extent. There are some locations which, in working with the wild fish sector, that they would identify as being sensitive. And some of the farms that are in those locations were put there several decades ago. So in the case of Loch Ewe, convener, because you specifically asked about that, we had a farm there where the view was that it was in a fishery which may be impacted. We debated that for many years, but in the end, we found a solution where we relocated that biomass to another location in support with the Fisheries Board and the Fisheries Trust. We've decommissioned the site. We've kept the people in employment, and they've moved to other locations, and we've managed to expand our production as a result of that move. And that is a step towards improved sustainability and a kind of win-win for everyone, ourselves and the wild fisheries sector.
Angus.
Okay, that's helpful. Kind of in addition to that, I mean, I was involved in the aquaculture bill when it was going through in 2012, and there was talk then obviously of significant movement with regard to taking the cages further out to sea, and you know, less in near the shores. What progress has been made on that?
Who'd like to go off on that? I guess it's probably you again, Ben, followed briefly by Anne.
Yeah, so a lot of companies, and my own included, had a policy of not really expanding inshore water unless they're able to do so with new technology or a new approach. We've identified a number of locations in kind of open sea areas in discussions with the planners and with other stakeholders, and a number of companies have been able to expand in those locations and create rural employment in areas of depopulation. Is taking place on Orkney, it's taking place in Shetland. In our own area, I can speak, if I'm involved in it, we've expanded on Mock and Rum and Colonsay, built houses, built infrastructure. And generally, we've been able to produce more fish, very high quality fish, in these open, exposed environments. But one of the risks that we have identified, and we are working to fix quickly, is that the escape risk is a little higher due to storm events.
Angus.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, convener. That's also helpful. One final question to Ben. The committee was told in 2018 that all of Maui's Scottish sites would be ASC accredited by 2020. So has that been achieved? What's the level of ASC accreditation in the industry overall?
Uh, Ben, do you want to go with that? Sorry.
Yeah. So there are multiple standards that companies choose to work to in order to supply their consumer base and the customers and demonstrate the highest production standards. We in Maui had chosen to go down the ASC route, which is Aquaculture Stewardship Council route. It has with it a kind of higher obligation on stakeholder consultation and sea lice control and working with the wild fisheries sector. The first step for us was to get all our freshwater sites ASC certified, which we did last year. And because those produced the smolts, that was the start point and indeed the blocker to getting the marine sites certified. We are now going through specific numbers of our five freshwater locations, they're all ASC certified. We are now rapidly certifying the marine sites, and we've employed extra people to do that. So 2 years on, we're harvesting ASC accredited salmon now. And many other companies, which Anne will be able to describe, are having similar standards to justify the highest welfare and environmental standards of production to their own customer base.
And do you want to come in briefly on that? Or has Ben answered it?
Yes, it was just to confirm ASC was very much ahead of other standards for some time. If you go back a number of years now around its wider environmental areas, there has been substantial changes in a lot of the accreditation schemes. And as Ben rightly stated, you know, companies are lined up to a number of different accreditation schemes. But the important key thing for us is that they address the key issues raised by the committee, and we'll continue to do so.
Okay, thanks very much, Anne. I think, Angus, that's your question answered. And if you're happy with that, I'm going to move on to Stuart Stevenson with the next question. Stuart.
Convener, thank you. Tavish Scott is being quite lonely there, so I'm going to address this question to him. We heard from Ben something about the use of cleaner fish. And I just want to ask Tavish, and of course you can invite someone else to answer if need be, when the industry will stop using wild cleaner fish, because it's pretty clear in Scottish waters that there isn't a sustainable population of cleaner fish to be harvested and brought in to eat the lice off farm fish. And if we're not in a position today to say when that will be eliminated, the alternative question is, when will we know when a date for eliminating it will be set? Tavish Scott.
Tavish.
Well, thank you, Stevenson. I suppose the best answer to give you is simply put is that we'll write to you with the details on that. As Ben said in response to an earlier question, we are going through a process on that, and I don't think today we could offer a precise view on the time scales. But you do raise a really important point. I think it's also relevant to recognise how important cleaner fish have been in the process of tackling sea life, and what an advance that has been for the sector and therefore for the environment. So let me do no better than simply say that we'll come back to the committee in writing on the best information we have on that, which does depend on our research and on research in conjunction with other parties as well.
Stuart, just before we move on that, can I ask a brief supplementary on that? Is I think that when we visited the various fish farms, that cleaner fish could be used legally for two cycles. I might have got that wrong, but they could be used for two cycles and then they had to be killed. Is that right? And they couldn't be used again. And there was a thing in the industry to say, well, they could do more than that, and that we were getting rid of a good resource that we ought not to be. Ben, have I got that wrong or is that right?
No, I think that's about right. Well, to go back to Mr. Stevenson's point, I think that a limited capture from the wild of clean fish is okay.
you know, prior to them being used on salmon farms, they were actually used as bait, or it was a high level of discard and mortality with it. So a small amount is probably okay, but the demand, as Mr. Stevens rightly pointed out, has been much higher than perhaps is sustainable in certain areas. So the industry has responded enormously on this through innovation. There's been projects of many of the companies involved in, and we are now on the cusp of being able to farm cleaner fish volumes in Scotland and in Wales and other locations out of England, where we've got disease-free, cleaner fish in good number with higher welfare, making a big impact on sea lice. And as we mentioned previously before, the next stage is to make sure that there is a circular use for those fish, so they're not wasted once the salmon cycle ends. Some of the big ballenrasse are quite long-lived, and you can reuse them for multiple cycles. And that is a good thing from a fish husbandry point of view, but there is a risk that they can become a vector to continue disease from one cycle to the next cycle. And fish farmers use the fallowing period to control disease in a good way. So I hope that answers it, but the thing that we can be proud of in the industry is just how quickly we've managed to innovate and close the farming cycle around cleaner fish and increase the number such that we don't need to continue to take them from the wild in the main.
Okay, Stuart. Sorry. Stuart.
Thank you, Convener. I just made the observation before I asked my next question. That there are a variety of cleaner fish used, and I think it's broadly accepted that we don't understand how sustainable some of those populations are. So let me pass on to the subject of acoustic devices, which Ben Hadfield made reference to earlier, and the papers that the SSPO has put to the committee talk about a risk assessment on that, and my questions are quite straightforward. Who is doing that, and is it being independently validated? And I make the observation that this is a very important issue, because I think it's now quite widely understood that a number of species that we're not targeting with submarine acoustic devices can at great distances be affected by the use of them. So just who's doing the risk assessment, and how is it being independently validated? And given that Ben raised the subject, I suspect he might want to pick that one up unless he directs otherwise. Convener.
Ben?
I'll just answer briefly, and then maybe Anne can take it forward from the whole industry. The permission to use acoustic deterrents has been removed by Marine Scotland, and they're in the process of being taken away from the farms. At the same time, we've had the Marine Mammal Protection Act in the US been brought forward, actually, surprisingly early. It doesn't come into place until 2022, but in a short space of time, those two control methods to protect your stock have been taken away. And, you know, don't forget, fish farms in a really difficult position here. We've got a legal and moral obligation to protect our fish from seal predation, which can be quite high in certain times of the year. And then the last thing that anyone wants to do is dispatch a seal or emit sound into the environment in an uncontrolled way. So I think the industry has been quite responsible about this. It's complied in full. If acoustic deterrents are going to be used in the future, then they need to be subject to important processes that measure and look at the effect on non-target species. But just to reiterate what I asked before, you know, we need help from the regulators to show a bit more flexibility to change equipment to exclude seals. It's a really serious issue, and you saw from the previous evidence that although we've got good regulation in Scotland, it's not the quickest to move forward. And we will have to go through a winter when seal predation on our stock impacting the welfare of the fish under our care could be quite high.
Anne, did you want to come in on that?
Yes, just to say that in answer to the question, we as an industry have the legal obligation to undertake the risk assessment. So first and foremost, each of the member companies are undertaking that risk assessment of the current stock of ADDs, which of course are varied. The supply chain businesses have also presented recent studies in the use of ADDs within the marine environment to Marine Scotland, which is the answer to the question on who does the independent assessment and validation. So this is a process that we're right engaged in right now and doing those submissions and assessments. The science is is under debate in terms of the recent findings. And of course, these are new reports that have been commissioned in 2020 by manufacturers of acoustic deterrent devices and devices that are used right across not just fish farming sector, but other fisheries within and other sectors within the marine environment. And this most definitely is an ongoing process. The law associated with the European Protected Species is that process of continual review now, and so that you would envisage that that will then occur if it is determined that any of those devices require a license, then application for that then follows, and that itself is an annual process. So there are software upgrades, there are changes in decibel frequencies, there's all sorts of new innovation coming forward around deterrence for use, but a lot of them are very much in that trial period, and of course that's where there's going to be continuing dialogue on this subject, Mr. Stevenson.
Thanks, Anne. Stuart.
And that's it, Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much, Stuart. The next questions are from Colin Smith. Colin.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I turn back to the issue around fish health in particular, and can I ask the panel what your current role is in delivering the farm fish health framework? I appreciate we've touched on a number of the work you're doing at the moment, but quite specifically on that framework, because obviously there has been changes in the structure of various subgroups.
Anne, you signed first.
Thank you, convener. Mr. Smith, as you said, the steering group has recently been reformed with Sheila Vose, the Chief Veterinary Officer, taking that position as chair, and she will be very much directing and creating the projects and work associated with those three themes. SSPO represents the sector, and we then pull in experts according to each of the topic areas. And we've been providing quite a bit of information behind in preparation to this next phase, looking at assessing, as Charles Allen referenced earlier, causes of mortality, and that the ongoing work associated with that has been underway, working closely with Fish Health Inspectorate through the period of time over 2020, where the meetings have not been held. There has been certainly continuing dialogue around establishing a really solid baseline of information and similar levels of work then done looking at climate change and the environmental impacts that we're experiencing in the farm, and looking at and trialling remote sensing technology to give indications of early warning. So quite a bit of substantial practical work and desk-based studies ongoing over this period of 2020, where clearly, you know, other aspects of government direction have been and very shortly, I understand the steering group will meet again and then formally commence the structure that's directed by Ms. Vose.
Ben, would you like to come in briefly?
I was involved in it myself on behalf of the industry. Progress was acceptable, but you know, you're impatient like I am, and you want better welfare for your fish. You want it to be faster. We managed to develop the transparency on sea lice, on reporting of mortality and disease status. The levels were brought down over time to have a higher degree of control on sea lice. There was work done on cleaner fish welfare. I personally think that the choice to put Sheila Boas in charge of that is a very good one and inspired choice, and I think that it will be all the better for it.
Colin.
Thanks very much. You touched on the issue of sea lice, and the SSPO's update to the committee says that the industry's annual average sea lice count is 0.5 adult female lice. Can I ask, what is the variation between fish farms? I mean, do we still have poor performers, and what level are those poor performers at? And also, is there a seasonal variation? And I think you mentioned, Ben, that figures were getting better. So are we seeing a proper performance improvement when it comes to overall levels of sea lice? And, you know, what is the information on that?
Okay, so, Ben, I'm going to get you to go on overall performance, whether it's seasonal, and maybe look to Anne or Tavish to go on the poor performers, because I don't think that would be up to you to point the finger there. So, Ben, if you start off, then Anne, and then Tavish.
So the general trend, and especially since 2018, when we gave evidence before, is that the sea lice control has improved. We've seen an increase in the availability of well boats providing fresh water treatment, which can be used to treat sea lice, and an increase in the amount of cleaner fish deployed and used. We've seen improvements in mechanical delicing technology, along with welfare improvements to salmon and cleaner fish. So the overall level is down. It's improved. It's very visible and very transparent now. So you can go on and look at any company and any site through either the company's website or more likely the SSPO website. I think I'll pass to Anne and Tavish to answer the other elements of the question.
Anne first and then Tavish.
Thank you, Ben. So in terms of, yes, there are outliers. The average across the sector, as you rightly stated, is 0.5, and that's our annual average. As Mr. Allen referred to in the previous evidence, there have been some uses of the enforcement policy with warning letters and advisory letters issued when those numbers have triggered, and that is the purpose of the trigger process and notification, very much around then the collective effort by the farmers, the vets and the health managers, bringing in the right treatment methods to then get that number back down into the target area, which for us is the 0.5 to 1. There is a seasonal element to this, most definitely, and in fact our particular focus that we put to the spring smolt season, so the run of the wild salmon, particularly focused in the West Coast areas. We collectively as a sector share information across member companies working across farm management areas, and very much focused on ensuring that we're managing that space throughout the year with particular attention to get the number below 0.5. And we've noted that the annual average recently has been 0.4, with every intention of continuing to drive that number down at that critical time, as we understand from our wild fishery colleagues, is needed.
So I'm going to bring in Tavish and then come back briefly to Ben, because I think he wants to add something there. Tavish, do you want to add something to this?
Just two very brief points to Mr. Smith's question. Is there fluctuation around the average figure, Mr. Smith? Yes, of course there is. You're absolutely right. By definition, it's an average figure. But as Anne has just illustrated, that area management regime encourages and indeed helps all farmers to come together to drive these figures down. And that's in the sector's interest. It's in the environment's interest, and it's in the sector's interest. And the second point that I think you've alluded to is that the transparency that the committee were looking for a couple of years ago, we've been extremely comfortable with that. We've absolutely driven into that space because it absolutely helps. There's no two ways about it. You well know in politics how transparency on figures of whatever data they might be can bring, as it were, a ray of sunshine into a tricky area. And that this is a tough area. It needs to be properly addressed. The industry is absolutely doing that, to the points that Ben and Anne have made. And I think the committee should take some credit for driving and for looking for improvement in this area, which we've achieved.
Ben, briefly, and then back to you, Colin, if you want to follow up.
Yeah, just very briefly, to answer the seasonality, which I didn't really do properly. The levels are at the lowest during the spring, as Anne says, and actually this time of year, that's the most challenging part of the sea ice control.
Colin, do you want to come back at all?
Just very briefly, I think it was Annette touched on this, that the direction of travel is, your current level is around 0.4, I think you mentioned. What is your target? Do you have a target for progress over the next, say, 12 months?
Anne?
Yeah, so in terms of that, across, we don't have a specified target. It's downwards and downwards and downwards would be my answer to that. And of course, that is evidenced in the trends over recent seasons. One of the key measures is ensuring that the information is available. So our data set, as Tavish pointed to, is fully available. And we made recommendations jointly with Wild Fisheries around supporting data sets on wild salmon itself. It's really, really key to share that information, to have an understanding of what's there. And of course, this is an area itself that the committee highlighted was not clear. And we are very, very supportive of any efforts that can be made to address and to fill in some of the gaps associated with understanding sea lice loads on wild salmon. That's particularly key because that then supports the efforts that we do in terms of addressing and managing the numbers lower and ever lower. So no specific target as such, Mr. Smith, set as yet.
Colin, Ben wants to come back in, so I'll let Ben in briefly. Ben.
Sea lice is many different, you know, the ones that we find on salmon have been around for about 6 million years, like salmon have. So it's not advisable to go for complete eradication. What we need to do is get to levels which present a little or no risk to migrating wild smolts. So that's why we as an industry have step forward and funded the West Coast smolt tracking study so that we can manage our levels to the lowest we can, but not go for zero, because then you run the risk of overusing the control tools you have, and then identify where the wild smolts are moving through the ocean as they move out to the feeding grounds, so that we can manage this together. And, you know, despite the fact that we haven't had a regulator champion in this, the industry and the wild fish sector have worked very well on it, I feel, over the last 2 years.
Thank you. The next questions actually are from me. So it's on recommendation 9 of the REC committee report, which regards current levels of mortality being too high and the need to bring them down. We heard in the last panel that mortalities were pretty constant across the industry. Does somebody want to tell me if you're making improvements on mortalities and whether the mortalities in 2020 are reflective of previous years? Anne.
So 2 years since we were last sitting talking on this topic, and we provided you the details of substantial investments across a broad range of actions and activities. Now, the reason for that is very much around improving the survival rates of Scottish farm salmon. We're 13 generations away from wild salmon itself. And our survival rate, our annual average, as we've indicated in the information to you, is 85.5%. So 17 out of every 20 salmon in the marine pen surviving. That comparison, when you think about that 13 generation on wild salmon, I understand from those dialogues, a close dialogue with Fisheries Management Scotland, that recent studies in Ireland indicate a very sad survival rate of less than 5% for marine wild salmon. Now, but integrated health management is really, really key to establish and to drive upwards our survival rates. And the investment at the freshwater stages starts very much at the beginning of at the egg stage, where we're looking at genetics.
Anne, I am going to interrupt you. I asked a specific question was whether the survival rate this year was the same in previous years, and the regulators said to us at the last session that they were fairly constant. Is that the case? I understand you're doing a lot of work. I'm asking if the two facts we've been given are correct. Anne?
I would state that the ongoing survival rates on farm are slowly reducing, and where you see that constant nature is as a consequence of isolated and rare conditions where we have high mortality events, which is where that average figure would then look to be and is, as you state, constant. So that there is a difference between the routine farm mortality and then addressing, understanding and being able to respond to the issues that Mr. Allen spoke to around environmental impacts and compromising our fish, and understanding the process to that and providing a range of actions to support greater survival through those incidents.
Okay. Ben, do you want to try and answer the specific questions that are the rates about the same as previous years, as we've been told earlier, and are the rates for this year the same? Because I have a follow-up question which I want to ask. Ben.
So the rates have been similar, around 15% in the marine trades. And the reasons for the mortality have moved away from sea lice and treatment losses, and they've moved on to gill health issues, which is a reflection of the temperatures that we've had in 2020, particularly the light levels, the concentration of algae in the seawater. So, but basically, the level's similar, but the reasons for mortality have changed.
Okay, thanks. That's interesting, because I did a bit of research prior to this meeting, and I found your figures very difficult, because you give mortalities in percentages of production. So taking 3 months, and based on the figures that SEPA have given us, June there were 1,500 tonnes of salmon that died. July there were 2,200 tonnes of salmon that had died. And in August there were 5,150 tonnes of salmon that have died. That's 8,800 tonnes, which will require over 300 articulated lorries to move them, which effectively is enough lorries to stack up the roads between here and Murrayfield. Now, what we're saying, and Tavish, you might not like it and raise your head, is the committee raised a question about recommendations in 9 about the mortalities were being too high. I am concerned they remain too high. Can you give me some confidence that these figures are abnormal, or are they normal and acceptable? Ben?
Nobody is more worried about mortality than people that are involved in this industry and take a wage or have a job or run a company. So, you know, the most difficult conversations that I have with my bosses and board is about mortality increasing or staying stubbornly high. But you cannot just wave a magic wand and demand that it comes down. The industry is doing its utmost to address this issue, and it's making real progress. In 2019, the majority of our mortality was from a bacterial disease called Pastorella skyensis. Prior to an outbreak in 2019, it had been a curiosity in Scotland, and we suffered from it. Within the space of a year, we had a vaccine and a complete absence from detection on our farms. And I know that other companies are doing great work on sea lice control and treatments and innovation regards closed containment, semi-closed containment, large smolts. So come and visit when we're able, when this COVID situation is hopefully resolved in the spring, and look at what's being done. It is impressive, but the rates are still stubbornly high for different reasons. And we're bringing all the resources we can to bear on that. And no one's more committed than the key players in the industry. But we're happy to write to you, give you complete clarity on this and list all the things that are being done, because quite frankly, I'm impressed and I'm proud of the sector.
I understand lots are being done, and I understand the commercial reasons for reducing mortality. Anne?
Yeah, it was just to refer back to an earlier answer that I gave around the importance of the regulatory regimes balancing fish health and the environment. And this is an utterly key point when you look at that marine space. Welfare of the fish balance with welfare of the environment and other species within it. So I think, you know, we are working closely, and I hope, you know, Ms. Vose will be leading very early the discussion and dialogue around access and use of medicines. They are an essential part of managing the health of anyone, including ourselves, and having access to the right volumes suitably then delivered and in balance is utterly key. And it's one of the reasons why we believe the regulatory regime for our farming activity in the sea does need some innovation around it to bring those different competing remits together and assessing the activity in the one place at the one time in balance.
Okay, we'll move on then to the next question, which will be from Mike Rumbles. Mike.
Good morning, panel, and particularly welcome to Tavish Scott, my ex-party leader. But Tavish, that doesn't mean to say I'm going to give you an easy question. In our report of 2 years ago, the committee highlighted that there is need to be a far greater transparency in reporting mortality rates and disease outbreaks at salmon farms, whilst it welcomes the publication of the SSPO of monthly mortality data for each salmon farm in August 2018. It notes that this information is very limited and does not provide detailed information on the causes of mortality on each farm. And in the your response, the SSPO's response to this committee meeting today, in your update, you said that the sector has complied with the provision of mandatory data to all regulators. Now, I would expect you to do that, of course. Absolutely right. But as I understand it, member companies of the Scottish Salmon Producers Organisation, who also operate in Norway, published far more detailed data on a farm-by-farm basis in a shorter timescale than we do here in Scotland. So first of all, am I correct in that statement? And if I am correct in it, why can't the member organisations that are doing this in Norway do it here in Scotland on a voluntary basis?
So I'll come to Tavish, and then well, I think it's only fair that Ben, who works in both environments, I think will have a comment. Tavish.
Well, thank you. Very good to see you, Mr. Rumbles. I seem to think that you asked me more difficult questions when I was leader of a political party than but I take your point entirely seriously. Anne and Ben can speak to the situation, obviously, in Norway, but I think I'm right, and again, my colleagues will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think Scotland publishes more in this area than any other salmon-producing nation across the world. And I think it's probably quite important to recognise the point about whether data could be produced in a more transparent or easily understood manner. We'll take that and look at that. But I think it would be best probably to have Ben draw the parallel with Norway and provide his international comparisons and indeed expertise.
Ben, over to you.
Yes, well, I think the progress that was made to present mortality was good. It's not as well presented as it is in Norway. They have a system called BarentsWatch, which presents climatic data, oceanographic data, it presents wild capture fisheries data, and it presents sort of disease mortality, sea lice and aquaculture. We kind of are willing to undertake and push for the development of that so that the data is more easily read and accessible. But I think if you know the industry, and many people do, you can gain a lot from looking at the SSPO's website. In terms of the difference between Norway and Scotland, we want to be transparent and we want to present this, but we don't want our industry to be subject to unfair attacks and criticism. We're a mature industry and we're quite willing to take criticism and reflect and change. But in Scotland, as you know, we have a number of activists that focus specifically on a company when mortality is occurring. And that's really unhelpful, because if you're a fish farmer and you care about your stock and you care about your business, your focus is on managing the situation and preventing further mortality and getting full control. So having to deal with activism and focus is a concern for some people. And so there are some farmers
that have been reluctant to go down the transparency route, and the SSPO has helped them achieve that. We will take on board that the Barentswatch system in Norway, which was funded by the government at great expense, is better on presentation, and we will work on this going forward.
Ben, could I just
absolutely
I understand exactly what you're saying, but your company does do this in Norway. It actually, you must have an internal company system for responding in this way, but you don't do it here. And I know the regulatory system is different, but what I'm asking is on the voluntary bit, and it is 2 years since you raised this point, and I hear you're saying you're willing to look at this, but it is 2 years we've been talking about this. Can we have some real progress? I actually think it's in your own interests. I've been trying to be supportive here. I think it's actually in your interests. If you're doing this in Norway, you should be able to do it here. And you said, you were weary of unfair attitudes and criticism. But one of the ways of getting rid of that unfair criticism and getting rid of those attitudes is to be as open here as you are in Norway, and as quickly open with the information that you are in Norway.
Ben.
Yeah. I think we're almost on the same page, if I can be as bold as to say that. My company was publishing this data in 2016, and then the industry moved to publish it just before the previous inquiry in 2018. The granularity of the data has got better over time. You can go into any site. It's like coming into my company or other companies and looking at the data records for mortality, cause of mortality, sea lice, etc. So what you want to see is there. But I kind of admitting and suggesting that we look to Norway on this occasion, as they have a very, very slick system of presenting environmental data, aquaculture data, and climatic oceanographic data. But it was put together at great cost by the Norwegian government, which is in possession of a sovereign wealth fund that gives them a lot of resource. So we are committed to improving it over time, but frankly, we just don't have the budget, especially this year, to copy what Norway has done. I hope that answers it, but I don't think we're far away. We've taken on board what you said about transparency, and I thought it was good advice, and we've tried to follow that in the SSPO as a community.
Okay, Ben, I think you've answered his questions. So that takes me to the Deputy Convener, Maureen Watt. Maureen.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, panel. Congratulations on your new job, Tavish. Quite a challenge. Can I move on to community benefits and community engagement? Clearly, the industry has its detractors, but in terms of the communities that you work in, are there any detractors within the community, and what is the basis for their concerns about fish farming?
Who'd like to head off with that? Probably Tavish, do you want to go with that to start with, and then probably push it to Ben as he's working in communities? Tavish.
Well, very good afternoon, Maureen. Very nice to see you. Look, you ask a good question. May I put my old hat on as an MSP for Shetland? Yes, of course there are individuals, even in islands where the industry employs what 2,000 people indirectly and directly, very, very important economically, and hugely influential in terms of the wealth in a community, how much money goes back into the community in terms of wages, tax, you name it. Are there people who are, as we'd say in Shetland, ill-pleased? Yes, of course there are. There are always going to be detractors. What I think we're seeking to do, and it's one of the key points in our sustainability charter, is to look at establishing, in consultation with the government, a structured community funding mechanism, ensuring local areas do benefit from the fact that the salmon sector is in those communities. Now, that won't solve all the problems of those who simply wish to oppose the sector, but what I think it does do is possibly give a little more structure to the very significant investments that, for example, Ben's company and all our member companies have made in the localities that they farming, whether it be in play fields, in sponsoring shinty teams, or up in Shetland in lots of different ways that I remember and have been part of for many, many years. So yes, we're going to put in place, in conjunction with the government, a more structured approach to that, and we'll be very happy to come back to you with more of those details as that policy develops.
Have you got any idea how that's going to work in practice currently?
Tavish, did you get that?
Well, perhaps, yes, thank you, Convener. Perhaps Ben could talk to how it's acting right now, in the sense that I'm very well aware in a local context of what individual member companies have done to support local community. What I'm saying in relation to how we're going to take this forward is we're going to work with the government and indeed others, i.e. local people and local groups, to put in place a mechanism to drive what I think is very much a shared agenda between our sector and your committee in terms of coming up with the right mechanism to deliver this.
Ben.
So we enjoy a lot of support from the communities that we work within, but they're very much the silent majority. You know, most of them are getting on with their lives, enjoying a career, bringing up the families involved in aquaculture, whether that's in US or Lewis or Orkney or Shetland. You know, these are great people. Joke before, I'm an Englishman. I've lived here for 20 years, but I've worked for 20 years alongside them, and they're passionate about what they do. So, you know, the benefits are a kind of average wage of around £37,000. The community development, the infrastructure, the career development, it's all extremely positive, stemming from aquaculture. We don't take away from the fact that we have an active and sometimes quite vociferous critique, base of critique. And I don't want to dismiss the claims, but we enjoy a lot of support from the communities, and rightly so. We are focused on increasing our transparency, and I'm sure that with Tavish now heading the SSPO, that he's able to speak with authority of the benefits of aquaculture to remote coastal communities and to Scotland as a whole. And he's able with his team to address some of the issues that were criticised on. And we will step forward and take that in a more and more open way, being proud of what we do, but accepting that we need to make improvements along the way.
Maureen.
Your new charter commits to developing high quality, affordable and green housing in partnership with local authorities, government and other partners. Do you see a big role for developing climate change policies through your charter? And in case the convener doesn't let me in again, can I ask for a quick comment, probably you, Tavish, on the news in the media today about Greg Seafood, who work in Shetland, and Skye ceasing their operations in Scotland? And is this a portend of something further to come from other companies, or what's behind it?
Tavish, do you want to head off on that?
Yes, thank you. Maybe I could let Anne deal with a very good question about housing and the sustainable charter. But on Greek Seafood, if it's a help to the committee, I believe that while it's a worrying time for the couple of hundred people who I well know back in Shetland, that the Greek Seafood strategy of seeking it in some period over the next period of months to divest themselves of the Shetland, of their Shetland assets, in other words, of the farms and of the processing factory in Lerwick, will lead to a process where those assets are taken on by another company. I don't think there's any doubt about that whatsoever. I think there'll be a seamless transfer. And while the corporate brand on the boiler suit and the survival suit may change, I have no doubt that the very able staff who work currently for Grieg and are brilliant people in the salmon farming sector will soon be working for someone else. Don't know what the timescale is, and I certainly don't know who will end up being the owner of those assets, but it's a great operation, and I have no doubt it'll soon be, at some stage, be operated by someone else. I hope that's some reassurance to the committee, and indeed, if I may say so, to lots of people who I personally know.
Thanks, Tavish, for that. And I'm going to come to Anne, but Anne, I'm going to ask if you can be succinct in your answer on the green issues that Maureen's raised.
Convener. Our intention throughout the strategy, not just with housing, which references working in partnership with local authorities, government and others, is to ensure that where we need to provide suitable, safe and sustainable actions for our business and our people, we're also been able to benefit those communities. Indeed, that's our belief around access to land for electric vehicle charging. Doing that in a public-private partnership context is also interwoven when you look at other sectors operating adjacent to us. And it's the challenge that we all face around rural parts of Scotland is identifying suitable housing stock that currently is either utilised as second homes or, you know, the self-catering market. So making sure every action that we take is complementary to that bigger piece and done wherever possible in partnership with other businesses that we work alongside and with those communities that we are part of. And that's really key, as I indicated earlier, to the approach we've taken right the way through our charter.
Thanks very much, Anne. And I'm now going to come to the last questions, which are from Emma.
Thank you, Convener. It's always difficult to be last because then I'll need to be succinct. But I'm going to ask a couple of questions about innovation and technology. I've got about 12 tabs open on my computer and everybody's doing something about different ways to improve salmon farming, whether it's filtration of water systems or oxygenation or medicines or food, food approaches. But I'm just wondering if you can outline what role that you're playing in researching and developing new forms of technology to improve the performance of salmon fisheries. And my second question, I'll just ask them both at the same time, is what is the SSPO's current position on closed containment forms of aquaculture? Because I'm also reading about semi-closed containment proposals for the likes of Loch Long salmon. So that's two questions, technology and innovation, and then closed containment.
Okay, and I fear that could open the floodgates to every single thing that's being done, which could take us up till probably tea time, I suspect. But Tavish, do you want to go on closed containment? And then I'll come to Ben and then to Anne to give a couple of salient points on what are being done. Tavish.
So in the interest of brevity, Convener, I'm going to pass the buck completely to Ben and Anne on this one because they will give you a succinct answer when I simply couldn't.
I've never known. You wouldn't have done that when you were a politician, but on the basis that you're now passing it to Ben, I'll let you go first, Ben, followed by Anne.
Thank you, Tavish. Yeah, it gives you an indication of how much innovation takes place in this sector. We have forms of closed containment in our RAS systems, recirculating aquaculture systems, where we farm smolts. Many companies are looking at whether these can be done on land. There is a general negativity about that from traditional salmon farms because it has with it a CO2 emission profile, which is much higher than the benefit that we have of using nature to farm high quality fish in the ocean and have the waste assimilated sustainably. So I think anyone that rushes to close containment or on land salmon farming is a panacea. With all the respect in the world, I think they need to spend more time understanding the impacts that will stem from it. Having said that, a number of companies are looking at hybrid approaches where they may grow fish to be larger on land and reduce the cycle in sea for environmental benefits and sustainable benefits for waste production. A number of companies are looking at semi-closed containment where you can exclude sea lice using skirts around the pens or pumping water from depth. And much of that is already taking place on the farms at the moment. With any sector that's developing at pace, there's a surge of new companies moving into the sector. And some of these are looking at closed containment, bringing the waste on land for treatment. It may work. I'm sceptical about that on a personal level because I think that bringing large amounts of effluent with high salt content on land may actually cause more problems, and it may not be necessary. But in summary to the question,
many companies are looking at hybrids of semi-closed containment to expand production or improve sustainability in the sea. And the final point I would make is it's really important that Scotland leads on this, because all the benefits that, that Tavish referenced and I mentioned before about the value of this sector as Scotland's largest food producer and now really quite a high average wage payer with a career path, we have to keep that in Scotland. If everyone moves and touts the advent of land-based farming, that is more likely to be based in Florida and China. And we don't want to lose the benefits of salmon farming from the west coast of Scotland and the highlands and islands of Scotland.
Anne, would you like to come in on that?
Just to build on Ben's point, you know, Scotland has that history of invention and innovation, and our sector is absolutely no different. We embrace innovation and research and development that leads to further innovation, investing across all the areas that you referenced, and actively trialling and supporting SME businesses. Tavish referenced the 3,500 SME and supply chain businesses that we operate with. And out of their inventions, do we then trial and test across the different areas from feed to barriers to oxygenation units and continually seeking new partners. COVID being an example of oxygenation and identifying new businesses within the Central Belt who were looking at providing oxygen for ourselves and quickly. So, you know, constantly looking to see how you can mobilise such that large scale and the idea, so both not just in the lab, but large scale can downsize to fit farms and laboratory, and thoughts can then materialise onto the farm. There's a substantial range of that, and I'm happy to provide you an update of the work we've got underway through 2020, that'll take us forward over the next 2 years.
Thanks very much, Anne.
I think innovation is worth more than a page because there's so much going on that it might be worth exploring that either in a further report or not an inquiry or anything, but just in more detail.
Thank you. I think that brings us, well, it does bring us to the end of our questions and the end of a process, I guess, or partly end of a process in the fact that we carried out our inquiry in 2018, recognising the importance of the salmon farming industry to Scotland and the need for the industry to be leading the rest of the world. Now, we will have time to reflect on the answers today, and I'd like to thank you, Tavish, Anne and Ben, for the answers that you've given us so that we can question the Cabinet Secretary when he comes in on the 2nd of December. And I'd also like to thank you in advance for the information that you've offered to send the committee, not only on innovation, but the other details. I think, Tavish, there are a couple that the clerks will be in touch with you about. So thank you very much for your time on this, what is really clearly a very important industry for Scotland. So we are now going to move on to agenda item 3 on our agenda this morning, which is we've received consent notifications in relation to 3 UK statutory instruments as detailed on the agenda. These instruments are being laid in the UK Parliament in relation to the European Union Withdrawal Act 2018. Now, there have been a couple of points raised in our papers, and I wondered if any of the committee members had any comments they want to raise. I'm not seeing anyone indicating. So does the committee agree to write to the Scottish Government to confirm its content for the consent to the UKSIs referred into the notification? And does committee also wish to highlight the points that were raised in the briefing paper as part of that consent? We're sort of nodding and thumbs up. So that's agreed, and we'll now move into private session on Microsoft Teams. Thank you.